Yeah, it is working. Yes. Okay, let us make a start now. Aibowan, Vanakkam, Assalamu Alaikum, greetings to all. My name is Lionel Bopage, one of the co-conveners of the Voice for Democracy in Sri Lanka International Collective and president of the Australian Advocacy for Good Governance in Sri Lanka. I welcome all of you who have joined via Zoom, Facebook, and YouTube. This webinar is being conducted from the traditional lands of the First Nations people, the Wurundjeri of the Kulin Nation, who are the traditional custodians of this land. We pay our respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging, and the elders of other communities. Before I start, let me express our solidarity and deepest respects and admiration to the peaceful protesters in Sri Lanka. They have been twice subjected to brutal attacks. Once on last May 9th by the Mahinda Rajapaksa's thugs, and the day before yesterday by Ranil Wickremesinghe's thugs, allegedly by ex-servicemen of Ratna Lanka Security Company, affiliated with avant-garde of Nissanka Senadhipati. These ex-servicemen are said to have been dressed up as an Air Force unit. By doing this, Ranil has started the inexorable process that will carry his regime to the dustbin of history. We have a direct question. Who directed those midnight attacks and under whose orders? Did those orders come from Ranil Wickremesinghe? Were ex-servicemen used as paramilitaries, as they did so in the 88-89 period? Protest movements have existed throughout the world whenever people were oppressed. This month is known as Black July because of the brutal killings and devastations done by Jayarajavardhana's regime in 1983, of which Ranil Wickremesinghe played a critical role. Now, Ranil Wickremesinghe has made the month of July even darker by attacking peaceful protesters. We strongly condemn the inhumane and atrocious attack on the protesters in Goldface Green by the security forces and Ranil's thugs less than 24 hours before he was appointed president. The so-called democratic leader took away the democratic right to freedom of expression and freedom to peaceful protest. Both local and international journalists and social media activists were attacked and their equipment was damaged. And this was fully broadcast over the international media. Already, many in the international community, including the United Nations and the European Union, have condemned such attacks. How can such an undemocratic, violent regime be supported by anybody in the diaspora? A legitimate question everybody in the international community, including us in the diaspora, need to ponder. Nevertheless, we wish the people and the protest movement in Sri Lanka all the best in achieving their objective of building a better and a fairer society. Friends, we cannot have any realistic hope of overcoming the present crisis in Sri Lanka unless we critically look at the issues that led our society into it. The economic issues are inseparable from the social and governance problems that underlie the crisis. Also crucial is the need for genuine reconciliation between communities. The July 83 pogrom was the culmination of a series of increasingly violent riots against the Tamils. These were issues that were deliberately created for sustaining the interests and privileges of the ruling elite since 1948. The Parliamentary Elections Act of 1949 disfranchised almost a million Tamil state workers and served as a harbinger of a unitarist authoritarian state. The first riot targeting Tamils took place in 1956 in Galloya. with 150 reported dead. Then came the 1958 riots, in which around 300 were killed, mostly Tamils. With the riots against Tamils becoming more repetitive, the ethnic relations became increasingly inflamed. In 1963, 1977, 1981, and 1983, many hundreds of Tamils were tortured and killed, thousands of their properties looted and set on fire, and many Tamil women raped. In each instance, the perpetrators and their political backers were granted impunity for their crimes by the increasingly authoritarian, corrupt, and unaccountable political elite who used the poor as scapegoats for their felonies. At the time of the July 1983 pogrom, I was General Secretary of the JVP. I was helping out with our publications at Shakti Press at Kohilavatta. I did not have a clue as to what was going on outside. I proceeded to the party head office and then home in Kadavata. On my way, I witnessed many properties were being set ablaze. Some have already been gutted. Some groups were assaulting and torturing innocent individuals. Security forces on the streets did not try to prevent violence or arson attacks. The next day, the guardian angels of the law were strangely absent, while armed mobs equipped with voting lists were ferried frequently by government lorries. They went systematically to the households and shops owned by Tamils in Colombo, many of whom had voted to the UNP government that was in power. The mobs stole their possessions, money, and jewelry, and burned the houses of any Tamil they knew of, in many cases, incinerating or beating the people to death. Around 150,000 fled from the south to the north and Tamil Nadu. Scapegoats were conveniently found, and the Janata Vimukti Peramuna, the Communist Party of Sri Lanka, and the Navasama Samaja Party were proscribed. On news media, several leaders of the JVP, including myself, were named as wanted as the masterminds behind the riots. In early August, I was detained under emergency regulations based on an order made by Colonel C.A. Dharmapala, the then Secretary to the Ministry of Defense. Was the ambush by the LTTE of a patrol of Sinhalese troops that killed 13 soldiers the catalyst of this program? The army retaliated by killing around 60 civilians that nobody talked about, and no investigations were ever held. The dead bodies of the Sinhalese soldiers were publicly displayed in Colombo with the intention of initiating the riot. I insisted that the Criminal Investigation Department should arrest the ministers, Buddhist monks, and others who, according to the information I had, were responsible and or led the riots. Detained with me were many comrades, some of whom you may know. Dr. Nihal Abhesinghe, the current General Secretary of the National People's Power. Comrade Vijita Ranaveera, former JMP MP for Tangol, and Professor Atul Sumathipale. The investigation of the CID concluded that the JVP was not involved in the July 1983 riots. With no success in their effort to get my support to the UNP regime, I was detained and kept incommunicado. My wife Chitra filed an application for quashing detention order and habeas corpus directing that I be produced before the Court of Appeal. I need to express my gratitude to late Mr. Nimal Senanayake, the then president of the Bar Association of Sri Lanka, and his team of lawyers who appeared for me pro bono. The unbelievably horrifying Sinhala fanaticism drew more and more Tamil youth to the LTTE. After the riots, an amendment to the constitution enacted in August 1983 outlawed the advocacy of separatism. As a result, all TULF MPs were expelled from the parliament. This autocratic move of the Jayawardena regime not only deprived Tamils of their democratic right to political representation, but reinforced the views of the Tamil youth that the only way forward was an all-out armed struggle for a separate state. We are still living with the wounds of this deadly legacy. That is why this webinar seeks to explore the context and history of the July 1983 anti-Tamil pogrom, its impact on the subsequent violent episodes in Sri Lanka, and its inherent negative influence on the country's economy. I will be moderating this webinar. I haven't been well. If I find it difficult to manage, I request Mr. Anthony Gration to take over. Mr. Ranjit Veersinghe will provide us with technical and administrative assistance. And Mr. Anthony Gration will extend additional administrative support. Ms. Sena Ratna and Mr. Mansoor will be assisting us with interpretations in Sinhala and Tamil respectively. The format of this webinar is slightly different. We have three panelists making presentations. Each presentation is limited to 15 minutes. At the end of each presentation, there will be a 10-minute Q&A session. And at the end of the three presentations, we hope to have a general discussion for another 20 minutes or so. I ask the audience to please post your short comments and questions on the chat line or Q&A feature. To save time, please try and direct your query to a specific panelist. And I kindly request the panelists to provide short and succinct responses of no more than 3 minutes. This webinar will be mainly conducted in English, but anyone who is willing to speak in Tamil or Sinhala are able to do so. Feel free to do so. We are expected to conclude this webinar in 2 to 2.5 hours. Give me a second. Those who are with us on Zoom can listen to Sinhala or Tamil translations by following the instruction shown now on the Zoom screen. At the bottom of the screen, you will see the control panel with different icons. The second last icon on the bottom right-hand corner is the interpretation icon. Click this icon and then select the language you wish to follow. Then click the tab Mute Original Audio, which is highlighted in blue. If you cannot work this out, please send a note to Mr. Ranjit Veersinghe via the chat box, and he will happily assist you. Thank you. Now, let me introduce the first speaker. Give me a second. Mr. Bāshana Abeywardane is a journalist since 1992. He is a founding editorial member and later editor-in-chief of the alternative weekly newspaper, HIRU. He was forced into self-exile in 2006 and he currently serves as the coordinator of the exiled campaigning group, Journalists for Democracy in Sri Lanka, widely known as JDS. Over to you, Comrade Bāshana.
Thank you, Comrade Lionel. I would like to thank especially for Comrade Lionel and all those who are involved in organizing this event for inviting me to join the discussion. And as Comrade Lionel has already described, the events that we have seen in the past couple of weeks or past couple of months has unsettled us and has to a large extent disturbed us by bringing back the memories of the past that we have walked through. As we gather here to revisit a bloodstained chapter of Sri Lanka's history, as we all know, violence has exploded in the streets of Colombo. And as we all know by now, 2 days ago, in the dead of night over 1,000 troops of the Sri Lankan military, probably on the orders of their new political masters, marched down the deserted streets of Colombo to encircle and brutalize the youth who have been protesting for over 100 days, demanding a change of governance. And at least from the information that we have received as JDS, 14 have been hospitalized, including two who were critically wounded. And nine were arrested, nine were roughed up and arrested by the police, by the Air Force and military, and then handed over to the police, who were later granted bail yesterday evening. And I beg to differ from the information that Comrade Lionel shared about claiming that the responsibility should be basically put onto the this Rakna Lanka or people who have been basically been presenting themselves as the military, because I think there can be some people who have been brought down from various other places, but I am absolutely sure the Sri Lankan Army, Navy, Air Force, Police Special Task Force were involved in unleashing the violence on protesters, largely Sinhalese, throughout the last few months. So the attack offers no reason, in my opinion, to be surprised, because we don't need to be surprised and say that it cannot be the military, it has to be some other group, because I think we have seen enough violence unleashed by the military throughout the past 40 years against the Tamils, against the Muslims, and especially against the Sinhalese as well. And so there's no reason why we should try to explain it in more difficult terms when the actions of the people who were involved were quite obvious, and we have witnessed it throughout the history. So the attack, and that's why I say the attack offers no reason to be surprised, although many videos have surfaced where Sinhalese people were seen expressing their anger and shock to the soldiers. The essence of many such conversations I have seen on internet was like this, actually, where the Sinhalese civilians were saying to the uniform-clad military men, "We thought you were heroes. We glorified you, held you so high with utmost respect, and we held religious events asking blessings for you. And now you come down to the south and do this to us." And in one such video, one of the Air Force troopers arrogantly hits back, saying, "So who cares? We don't need your respect." And so 39 years after the Black July, we Sinhalese are back to square one. In no way we could compare the events and the state violence we have seen throughout the past few months with what the Tamils have been through, or what the Muslims have been subjected to throughout the past three decades. Even if you leave aside the monstrous experience of Tamils or the Muslims, what we have seen during the recent months cannot even be compared to the experience of the Sinhalese themselves, who had seen state-sanctioned violence in 1971 and 1989. So to be honest, what shocks me is not the controlled low-intensity state violence that has been unleashed during the recent months against the peaceful protesters. But what shocks me is the collective shock expressed by the Sinhalese, who are now at the receiving end, who seem to be completely taken by surprise and to realize that the Sri Lankan military is capable of unleashing violence, which has been the hallmark, actually, of the Sri Lankan military throughout the last four decades. That state of shock expressed by the Sinhalese population brings out a fundamentally important aspect of our collective national psyche. That aspect is the shocking lack of historical literacy. That's what I think. What is absolutely surprising is how much we have forgotten. And we don't need any other explanation to understand the violence that we witnessed 2 days before. And that is exactly the same violence that has been unleashed against various kinds of people, against the Tamils, against the Muslims, and against the Sinhalese as well, throughout the last four decades. And we pretend that we don't remember. And there's a reason why we pretend that we don't remember. Unlike the Tamils or the Muslims, our collective existence as a nation depends on our ability to forget. We can call ourselves as a nation because we have decided to forget what we have been through. Unlike the Tamils, whose collective existence depends on the extent of their the extent of how much they remember. And that actually, that we cannot deny the atrocities committed against the Tamils or the Muslims if we remember. If we remember, we will remember the generations died in 1971 uprising. We will remember the generations that died in 1989 uprising. And we remember how brutal the experience they had to go through. How people were burnt alive by the state military in 70s and 80s. And we, in order to express ourselves in a collective manner, to call us a nation, we have a secret agreement. It's the secret life of the master race, what we are talking about, to quote Bertolt Brecht. It's a secret life of the master race. We have collectively agreed to suppress and bury the memory that made us to realize what the state is capable of, what the state armed forces were capable of. And therefore, all of a sudden, when we see a controlled state-sanctioned violence on the streets of Colombo, we pretend to be shocked because we don't know history. And the lack of historical literacy is what makes us politically impotent. And that's what makes us politically we unimaginative, actually. And so let me start an important fact. Now, again, I beg to differ with the way in which the Black July events are being defined in the title of this webinar. Now here it's called 1983 July riots. And in my opinion, there were no riots in July. It was state-sponsored, organized violence against the Tamils in the country. There was no riots. And to quote late Ambalavana Sivanandan, one of the most important Marxist activist intellectual who contributed immensely to understand the link between racism, capitalism, and imperialism in Europe. In an article written in 1984, titled Sri Lanka, Racism and the Politics of Underdevelopment. Now he starts with the following paragraph, and let me quote. There have been no race riots in Sri Lanka since independence. What there has been is a series of increasingly virulent pogroms against the Tamil people by the Sinhala state, resulting in the degeneracy of the single society and its rapid descent into barbarism. Now, everything succinctly put into one paragraph, and this is what we saw in 1983. In that spirit, I would call it 1983 July pogroms, which means organized mass violence, atrocity crimes committed against the Tamils sanctioned by the Sri Lankan state. And let me start telling my own experience. In July 1983, I was an 11-year-old school-going kid preparing myself for the grade 5 scholarship exam. Weeks before that, the South exploded. And that was my first experience of witnessing unimaginable violence in which I lost my own friends who were studying at the same school like me. And some died and some left the country. And 8-year-old Tamil dentist named Dr. Nathaniel and his elderly wife was hacked and burned in a village of Central Highlands where I lived with my parents. There were no politicians and there were no state-sponsored thugs. And that unimaginable crime was actually committed by ordinary neighbors. We shared our lives, day-to-day lives, and fellow villagers who carried out that attack. An adopted son of that Dr. Nathaniel, who studied in my school, vanished and nobody knew what happened to him. He wasn't killed, but he vanished. It may not be the case in some other areas. People may have different experience, basically to prove the point that the state-sponsored thugs actually carried out the attacks, but not in my case. Not the event as an 11-year-old child I witnessed. It was teachers, garment servants, the priest in the temple, and many other ordinary people who were doing farming in the Central Highlands. But it was the case in small village of Bandarville, where I lived back then. So in my opinion, the violence was not spontaneous. It was premeditated, as we all know, but not in the manner many want us to believe after 34 years, because there's a kind of a tendency to revise history. And whatever that we have seen since 1983 in fiction, in films, in teledramas, it basically presents a different kind of narrative. And that narrative is solely focused on trying to absolve ourselves from the collective responsibility of those crimes which happened in front of our own eyes. It was not simply a conspiracy. People did took part in violence, regardless of what percentage they represent. They had an active role. They did participate. That I know for a fact from my own experience and from the stories I heard since then from my friends, from my political colleagues, and many others. But that was a watershed moment in my life, because those violent events set an uncontrollable vicious cycle of violence in motion, which engulfed where I lost many of my friends from my own generation in the years that came afterwards. The violence and events that followed actually shaped my life, just as it shaped many in my generation. A statement I have been repeatedly been saying is the fact that the values and the beliefs of our lives were not actually shaped by the way people lived in our country. That was shaped by the way people died in our country. And 4 years after 1983, my generation went through hell and fire. There are more than 60,000, almost 60,000 were either disappeared or they were burned to death. They were tortured and burned to death. And 39 years after, when you are revisiting the events in 1983, we must come out of the fictional accounts of what really happened. We need to admit, we have to find a collective sort of identity which basically can represent us from the positions that we take against the violence that was unleashed against Tamils and the Muslims, and especially in 1983, as far as Black July is concerned. We need to find a collective identity that basically distance ourselves from that violence in a way by saying what exactly happened, by exposing the crimes that were committed in the name of Buddhism, in the name of Sinhala race, or in the name of the state, committed against the fellow citizens in the country, the Tamils and the Muslims. And we have to come out of that kind of collective secret pact that we try to maintain even 39 years after. With regard to 1983 Black July, from Black July to 2009 Mullivaikal episodes, the secret pact that we are trying to maintain among ourselves, that it never happened, or we had no knowledge of what really happened, or to say that we didn't do anything. And that denial can give us a feeling that we constitute ourselves as a nation because we deny. And that denial makes and bounds us as a nation. But that is a denial, basically. That is an identity based on denying crimes that were committed. And that is an identity based on hiding the atrocities that were committed against the other people in the country. And that is a kind of identity that we are trying to acquire, basically, not by saying, yes, those atrocities happened, and we knew that was happening. And the new identity should be based on our ability and our willingness to expose those violence, expose the perpetrators, fight for justice for the other people who have been through that. And as long as we don't want to do that, as long as we try to hide it, as long as we try to maintain that secret pact among ourselves, which basically the foundation of the secret life of the master is, we will never ever learn the lessons. And history has been repeatedly it has confronted us to understand what the state is capable of what the military is capable of doing and how brutal the history can be towards us. And 1983, the 39th anniversary of Black July, has offered us to understand and to admit these events really happened. And the people did participate in these events. And throughout the last 39 years, we have tried as a nation to hide the magnitude of these crimes. We have tried to hide the disastrous consequences of these crimes. But we still try to repeat the same mistakes, and we still try to pretend that we are surprised by seeing the violence that has been unleashed on the streets of Colombo and many other parts of the country. And how did this happen? And how were they capable of doing this? Because simply, we lack historical literacy. And I think 1983 Black July, the commemoration of the events, basically as a Sinhalese, I believe that it has offered another moment for the Sinhalese to revisit the history, to learn, I mean, basically to teach the next generations what really happened in this country, what people have been put through in this country for decades, and to what extent the state, which is the biggest criminal in the history of this country, the state criminality is the elephant in the room. As long as we don't consider and confront the state criminality, it will keep coming to us. It will keep coming to us, it will go, because it's normally, there's a blowback effect. We were cooking, as we all know, we were cooking kiribat, we were firing crackers, and we were enjoying on the street, on the same streets, where now that violence has been unleashed by the same troops against the Sinhalese. And this is a moment to revisit the past, to be honest to ourselves, to revisit the past, to confront the political realities that we have basically and conveniently overlooked and swept under the carpet. And I thank Comrade Lionel and all those who are involved in organizing this event for inviting me to share my thoughts on this. And given the time constraints, I will stop here. But if there are any other questions or clarifications needed, I would willingly participate. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Comrade Bāshana. And thank you for the illuminating presentation, which brought out many facts about what happened in July 1983 and throughout the history of last 74 years. Now, we have 10 minutes of Q&A. Anybody who could pose a question. I have a feeling that there may be a problem on the chat line. If you have a problem on the chat line, you can write on Q&A. And I don't have a problem in writing on chat line, so I don't know what has happened. Or if somebody has a question to ask, short questions, you can raise your hands and I can allow you to speak. So if there are any questions, please post it now. And Comrade Bāshana, limit your response to 2 to 3 minutes. Is there anybody? Okay, I will ask Willie. Willie, you can ask the question. You have to unmute and ask.
Thank you, Lionel. Bāshana, thank you very much for your very interesting and enlightened presentation. My quick question actually is that all young people who have joined Aragalea, they all were born after 1983. So do you think actually they have any sense or any understanding of the atrocities committed in 1983? Thank you.
Respond, or should I wait? Can I respond, Comrade Lionel, or should I wait for another question?
No, you go.
Now, I think, Mr. Sena, it's a valid question, actually, and it is quite a crucial question, I think, because I think the lack of historical literacy, when I say lack of historical literacy, is actually, which is actually, the biggest victims are the generations who are actually confronting the state atrocities now, the state kind of injustice now, because they are thinking that this is, they're basically forced to think this has never been, never happened in the country, and they are the ones who are going through this first. And that's why the slogan, for example, you are messing with the wrong generation kind of slogan has come up. All the generations have been through this, from Comrade Lionel's generation and even generations before that. They have all been through this. And I think the reason that this generation not aware of the fact that there had been similar violence, and actually even if you look at, the, I mean, if you consider the magnitude of the violence is much, much more, much, much higher violence, is reason because the previous generations has not basically passed that knowledge to the generations, succeeding generations. And the reason is because, I mean, if you consider the fact, for example, if you allow me to take a best example I can take is that the People's Liberation Front or the JVP, which was actually the who stood at the receiving end in 1970s and the 80s. And they had been one of the most enthusiastic cheerleaders during the war. And they willingly decided to suppress the important history that should have been passed to the next generations to understand what kind of a state we live in and what kind of state we live under. This basic fundamental lesson has been denied by the People's Liberation Front to the next generations by simply maintaining the accounts of the survivors, what we have been through, what we have seen, and what the previous generations went through. And because of that, actually, if there's any lack of understanding about what happened in 1983 by the present generation, I think the fault lies with us and the generations before us, not with the generation who are on the streets now. Because the reason that they don't know, because there's no way they could know. Because that has been, because that's why I said the our collective existence depends on our ability to forget and our ability to hide the atrocities that were committed against us and that were committed against the Tamils and the Muslims.
Thank you, comrade. Is it Lukman, I think. You can pose your question now. I have allowed you to talk.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me, please?
Yes.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. Bāshana, my question is, you know, since 1983, there have been many other communal riots in Sri Lanka or anti-minority attacks. Now, the problem with all this is the common thread that has been going through all these things with regard to the accountability is the problem of impunity, the state impunity, and the lack of, you know, action against the culprits who have been doing this. So now, so many decades later, what is your reading or the thinking of history? How can we, you know, overcome this problem? How can the people's Aragalea, you know, bring that very important aspect to focus, the problem of, you know, fighting or defeating this problem of impunity? Please, thank you.
Yeah. Well, I think, I mean, this is also a fundamental kind of problem that we are actually, we have been grappling with for all these years, because impunity has become, I mean, has been the kind of most important aspect of everything that happened before us, I mean, in front of us and before our generations, because we haven't seen any action taken against the perpetrators of state-sanctioned crimes. We have never seen, since 1971, we can actually point out one or two cases like Premuthi Manamperi, and then again about Chemmani case and Shanti Kumaraswamy case, and very few. But when you look at the magnitude of the crimes and the extent of crimes, there had been absolute impunity for most of the state-sanctioned, I mean, perpetrators of state-sanctioned crimes. And I think, for example, we are not even disturbed by the fact these perpetrators walk, basically, I mean, they live with us, they are neighbors, they are traveling in the buses that we travel. And we are not even disturbed by knowing the fact we are sharing our day-to-day life with the people who have committed unimaginable crimes against various kinds of people. And in 1983 or even afterwards, for example, when I was going through, we had been working on a case, on a report about Matale in 1989, what happened in Matale, because there was a joint report that came out from the organization I represent, Journalists for Democracy in Sri Lanka, and International Truth and Justice Project. Now, in month of May, we actually released a report, which is basically trying to explain when Gotabe Rajapaksha was the district military coordinator, who was put in charge for 8 months in a small district where 360,000 people lived. And the balance sheet, when you look at the balance sheet, more than 700 people disappeared. And there had been at least 20 torture camps being operating in the region, in the district, in all of Matale district. And there had been, according to the government appointed commissions, which had done immense work to bring out the expose the atrocities that has committed in most part of the country, including Matale, it's shocking information. But the thing is, there hadn't been a constant effort to bring the perpetrators to justice. And if you compare it with a country like, for example, Guatemala or somewhere, you know, where there had been high intensity military conflict, where nearly 200,000 people died and 1 million people got displaced. This happened in 1983-84. And there had been a UN appointed commission, which looked into the atrocities that committed during that period, which is known as Historical Clarification Commission. And this Historical Clarification Commission ruled that the Guatemalan state is responsible and they are guilty of committing genocide against the Mayan Indians in Guatemala. And that happened in 1996. And we are talking in 2022. Still, the struggle for justice is going on. Still, people are trying to unearth the buried victims. They are trying to find the mass graves. And there are people who have been working on this matter for almost 3 decades to bring the perpetrators to justice. Even though we boast about that we have the highest literacy rate and all kind of the oldest democracy, we have to look at the absurd reality of Sri Lanka's history. Now, we called ourselves as the oldest democracy in Asia, which got the first adult voting right as the first colony in the entire British Empire. But we have the second highest number of disappearances in the world. And how can that completely conflicting two realities exist in one place? And that shows the lack of, that's a part of actually not having sense of justice, not having sense of, a will to know the truth. And also, it is also part of lack of our lack of our ability to extend solidarity, the human solidarity to others. And that actually allows people to live with these atrocities, live with the perpetrators. And I think I don't know, I have a clear answer to that, but I think I'm part of the question actually. I share the question with you because when Sunil Ratnayake walked out after Minusville massacres and after he was sentenced and when he was pardoned by the president, he walked out and no one seemed to be disturbed about that. I mean, a larger part of the population, but never disturbed by that fact that someone who was responsible for killing even 5-year-old child, slitting his throat with 8 others, nobody seemed to be bothered about why it should not be the thing that we should live with. And that's a kind of a fundamental problem that we have in our country, especially in our society, actually.
Thank you, comrade. Now, we have spent 10 minutes in the Q&A session. There are more questions, but maybe we can take up those questions during the discussion session at the end. But in the meantime, if comrade Bāshana could look at the questions posed on Q&A, and also there are some comments on the chat line, probably you would be able to type your answers if it's possible. Otherwise, we can leave it to the end. All right. Moving on, I would like to invite Mr. Shanakyan Rasamanikam. We all know a well-known member of parliament from the Tamil National Alliance for Batticaloa district, and he's a member of Ilankai Tamil Arasu Katchi, as far as I know. He's a Trinitian and chair of the SM Rasamanikam People's Foundation. You have the floor, Mr. Rasamanikam.
Uh, Thank you very much. Thank you, especially thank you for inviting me to speak as a panelist on this forum. It gives me great pleasure to be invited to speak and share my thoughts at this event. It's important that I say this as well. I was born in 1990, so 1983 is something that happened 7 years before I was born. And so I speak based on evidence or based on history, based on what I've read and what I've learned. I don't have firsthand experience of what happened in 1983. But I think it's very important. I think my fellow panelist, Bashita, when he spoke just a little while ago, the fact that he mentioned the narrative and the history that has been told about this event is not the same narrative that most common people share today. And also, it is sometimes worrying. Very well-read people, people who have powerful positions, who are genuinely, I would say, crusaders for peace and reconciliation, are also sometimes misinformed about 1983, or they have different perceptions, which sometimes worries me. For an example, 1983, very well-read person, presently in a very powerful position, working towards reconciliation. The first response, the initial response was, if I may say it in Sinhala, is Uture hamudawata gahapu nisa Kolamba me gehuwa waithin mok eka ehit merno ne me Uture Sinhala minissu merno ekata thamai mehe gehuwe. You know, that is the narrative that most people have, and I'm very thankful for people like Bāshana for actually, you know, saying what needs to be said, especially coming from the majority community. It's important because to change that narrative. And it's and what I like to say is that I always say this: in 1983, there were many militant groups. LTT was one of the militant groups, but the state has a responsibility to protect all its citizens. Just because a convoy of military was attacked in Jaffna, that gives no reason for any attacks to be carried out on citizens that the state is supposed to protect. So I don't want to take too much time on the history, because, you know, like I said, there are many experts on history, and my fellow panelists have also shared the events that happened and the narrative, the real narrative that happened. But however, it's I would like to focus on, you know, maybe being a youth. Maybe it's my urge. I always have an urge to feel hopeful. I always have an urge to look forward towards the future. But to go to work towards our future, it's important that we address our root cause. The root cause for this, the root cause for the 1983, what happened in 1983. Like Comrade Lionel, when he mentioned in his initial speech, the riot started from the 50s. You know, it was a continuation of this violence against the Tamils that ultimately led to what happened in 1983. But today, in 2022, we still have not addressed the root cause. The root cause has still not been addressed. The root cause for the economic crisis that we are facing today is people can blame corruption, people can point fingers towards mismanagement of finances, towards development that was not done with proper plan development that was done. But however, the root cause, yes, all that is true. There is some element of there is a lot of it is due to mismanagement. But why did we have such a large amount of debt is only because we never addressed our national ethnic conflict. From 1948 till today, 2022, we still haven't addressed the root cause. If the national ethnic conflict was resolved, the Tamil people were given political power that the Tamil people are still demanding 74 years after independence. If that had been granted, we would have never had a civil war. We would have never had a civil war that would have taken up so many lives. So it's unfortunate to see that even today, we have still not addressed the root cause. There are there are some elements who understand this, but then there are also some elements, you know, that which sometimes it worries me, is that yes, there has been a movement, an Aragalaya, and I have always been very much supportive of the Aragalaya, and I still am. And I think that is the only way, that this is the only Aragalaya in history. And there have been protests around the country which have led the country to instability. Through Aragalayas have been won through violence. But in Sri Lanka is one of the few countries that have had many opportunities to put the country on course. I don't think many countries have been that lucky, but Sri Lanka and Sri Lankans are so lucky. We have had many opportunities in our 74-year-old history to do the right thing. But I think it's another opportunity now. First thing is that that we can be the first country in history where, you know, through an Aragalaya, you know, government has been formed and the country has been taken towards stability, and the country has addressed the root cause, and country has prospered after Aragalaya, then be a country where, you know, we have continuous changes of governments. And unfortunately, with Honorable Ranil Wickremesinghe being getting elected as president through the parliament, not by the public, but just by 134 members of parliament who are completely disconnected with the ground situation, I don't know if Sri Lanka will have that opportunity in history to be the country that through an Aragalaya that we formed a stable government, through the Aragalaya that we had came to the right point. But just to what I was saying earlier, I am sometimes very concerned. I wonder sometimes if the Aragalaya or the public protest would have happened if not for the economic crisis. If the economy hadn't crashed, would we have had an Aragalaya? Right now, if the fertilizer supply had been there, if there was fuel supply, if there was power supply, everyone who are protesting right now, would they have come onto the streets to protest against the system? Would they have wanted the root cause addressed? And why I say this is that sometimes I wonder if it's Gotabaya Rajapaksha that has been kicked out, or if it's Gotabaya Rajapaksha's ideology along with him that has been kicked out, or the separatist racist ideology that has been used to come into power and stay in power that has been chased away. Would all Sri Lankans want to see a change in direction that the country goes, a change in the direction? Are they all wanting to address a root cause? So these questions need to be asked. We need to ask ourselves these questions. Or is it just that Gotabaya Rajapaksha's economic policies were flawed? We would want somebody, another Gotabaya, who could probably take us out of the economy. Is that what we want? So it is very important, and I am very, very much thankful for everyone who arranged this event, because this is very, very important. We had a crucial juncture in our history, and what happens in the next few months would decide the future of my generation, the future of the generation that is protesting right now for the right thing. So in 1983, we can today, on the day, you know, it could be in a way, I don't approve of any other lives lost. I don't approve, it should have never happened, but I'm saying that it could even be a blessing in disguise for Sri Lanka right now when he wants to put the country back on course. 1983 saw a large outflow of Tamil people who are now in the diaspora. They're called the Tamil diaspora. They're in very powerful positions. Many of them are very, they're entrepreneurs. They're very, very large business people. There are many industries that the Tamil people are in charge of around the world. Most of them fled the country in 1983, fearing for their lives. I'm sure people of that era people who experienced it or people who were alive during that period would tell today's generation that 1983, there were a large number of Tamil people who moved to the north and the east, and a large number of them migrated out of Sri Lanka as well. So today, that same people that the state chased away, that the state-sponsored terrorists chased away, could be the people who take this country out of this crisis. Looking forward towards our future, we need to address our root cause and we need to move on as a country. And is Sri Lanka ready for that? Or is Sri Lanka still wanting another leader like a Gotabaya Rajapaksa, but who would deliver on the economic front? Within a few hours after Gotabaya Rajapaksa left the country, there are many social media pages that are which I assume are paid adverts. I have been campaigning, especially monks have been campaigning, saying Gotabaya ratadala gihila pay 24ක් ඇතුළත උතුරේ ඉන්න සිංහල ජනතාවට මොනවද වෙන්නේ ධනමමන සංශෝධනය ගෙනල්ලා නැත්තම් බලය බෙදා ගන්නවා කියලා මේගොල්ලන් ඇවිල්ලා රටේ මේ ඉන්දියාවෙන් දැනටම ආයුධ ඇවිල්ලා තියෙන්නේ and it worries me. There are 6,000 7,000 people commenting on these videos saying swami nuhansira teruan saranai, no, so are we ready to move on from our mistakes? It's an important question that we need to ask ourselves, because for the same Tamil people who were chased away from this country by the state-sponsored terrorists, and the burghers were chased away before that by the Sinhala-only act. You know, we were such a gifted nation. Our diversity, which should have been our strength, was used as our biggest weakness. We were divided. So all these people were chased away from Sri Lanka at different points. They're happy to come back to Sri Lanka to reinvest. They're happy to help Sri Lanka come out of this crisis, but only if the root cause is addressed. Because what they feel is that since 1983 in the political space, nothing has changed. They feel that the root cause, the Tamil people's aspirations for political power, still has not been given. We're not asking for a separate state. So, because we need to understand, to come out of this economic crisis, we need a large influx of, we need a large cash infusion in foreign currency. If without a large infusion, maybe a couple of weeks, maybe a month, credit lines will work, different countries could donate, but without a large infusion of cash in dollars, I don't think Sri Lanka can come out of this economic crisis. So the same Tamil people who were chased away from the country in 1983 can be a blessing in disguise. We can change, we can rewrite our history. We can rewrite our future. We can plan our future, sorry. So therefore, I would again like to thank everyone who arranged this webinar. It's actually very useful, and I hope that this webinar can be, these ideas that were shared by the panelists could be shared on social media individually, because most people don't like to sit and watch videos that are 1-2 hours long. So the most important parts, if somebody, as much effort has been put into arranging, if somebody can put a little bit of effort to share these ideas with other people, that will be wonderful. So I would like to end my comments with that. I think I might have taken a little bit less time, but I would like to see if there are more questions that I could answer, because I give my opinion on these things on a lot of videos and blogs. So I think I'd like to save more time for the interactions. So thank you once again. And I hope that Sri Lanka will use 1983, not as another place for us to ponder over where we went wrong, but a place or an another opportunity that we could use to build a country and build a better future for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rasamanikam. And thank you for that. I think you're speaking from your heart as to what needs to happen, what to think about the history. It is again time for the questions. We have 10 minutes to pose any questions. You can raise your hand and then I will allow you to talk. And is there anybody who would like to? Okay. Yeah, I will be able only to take 3 questions. So I will start with, I don't know, it's Mr. Shakir. I will allow you to talk and please unmute and pose your question.
Okay. Thank you very much for allowing me to speak. This question is to the MP Shanakian. Now, the atrocities were carried out in 1983, and most of this information has now been coming up with the younger generation are admiring or seeing what has happened to the Tamil community. But we as a country failed to impart or tell this message in a broader level, in the village level, where most of these people were not aware. The younger generation over there is not understanding. Why not a system of a kind of a weird mugger is not started up or taken up in order to share this knowledge and thoughts amongst these, not the Colombo crowd or the city crowd or educated crowd. They all condemn what has happened to these 1983 atrocities. But we have failed in reaching to the village level. So what actions we should do or what would take in order to mobilize this change of mind and change of heart towards the Tamil and Muslim communities? Thank you.
Thank you, Shakir. It's a very, very valid point, and it does need to, the message does need to be taken to the grassroots levels. But I think, you know, overall, the government, it needs to be included in our curriculum. Our history books need to be rewritten. Our history starts at at a point that the government has, that's a narrative that whatever government has wanted to give out. So I think it needs to start from our history books that we learn from school from grade one. No, history doesn't tell anything about Tamil people before, during the ancient kingdom. So from that is what we are taught from a very young age. And yes, something like Viatmaga, I hope it's, I don't want to start a Viatmaga because we see what happened with Viatmaga and the lot from there. But yes, it's a very valid point, but the logistics and how we do it and financing and all that is a challenge. So we are always trying our level best to make sure that this message goes out to the grassroots levels. And I think it's a collective responsibility that all of us have as citizens to share these thoughts. And I think we should all do it, and eventually we'll get there. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Asanikam. Next it is Mutaya Jayendra. I will allow you to talk. Give me a second. Mutaya, please unmute and talk here.
It's about the root cause mentioned by Shanakian. It's actually the root cause is discrimination against the Tamils on the university admission. In 1976, there were Shreya Bhasha came to reduce the numbers of the Tamils entering. That is where the root cause started. So we must abolish the Shreya Bhasha and bring up English media and have the equal rights for the youngsters to enter the university and produce the excellent engineers and doctors for the country. That is my opinion, is the root cause. Thank you.
Yes, I think that wasn't a question, that was more of a comment, but I would like to elaborate on that. I think the root cause is, there are many events. I think Comrade Lionel mentioned some of them in his initial comment, when he initial presentation. Kicking out the Tamil people of Indian origin from Sri Lanka, making them not citizens of this country. You know, there are Galloya, Valioya, all these colonization schemes. Then the Single Only Act, then the standardization with the universities. So yes, you're right. It's like I said, the addressing, not addressing the national ethnic issue, where the power sharing has been the root cause, and the standardization is one of the contributing factors, is what I would say.
Thank you, Mr. Sonic. Next, which is Diane, I will allow you to talk. Diane, unmute them. Is that D? Do you want to unmute and post your question? Next, it will be ADCC Nimal Dishanayak. I will allow you to talk. Please unmute and post the question.
බොහොම ස්තුතියි මේ මම චුට්ටක් මම පාට පරක්කුණා මේකට සම්බන්ධ වෙන්න නමුත් මම මේ අපේ මේ රාසමානිකම් තරුණ මන්ත්‍රීතුමාගේ එක දවසක් පාර්ලිමේන්තුවේදී කරපු කතාවක් මට මගේ හිතට ගොඩක් වැදුනා ඔහු එක පාර්ලිමේන්තු සැසිවාරයකදී කියනවා මේ රටේ සිංහල මිනිස්සු සිංහල ජනතාව දන්නේ නැහැ ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ නායකයෝ ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ රවට්ටනවා කියලා ඉතින් අර ඒ කතාව හරහා මම දැක්ක සමහරක් Facebook මේම සංවාද වලදී සහ අපේ සිංහල කට්ටියටත් ඒක ලොකු මේ ආසාවක් ඇතුණා ඒ කතාව සහ ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ අවධානය ගොඩක් යොමු වුණා ඇත්තටම සිංහල නායකයෝත් අපු රවට්ටනවා නේද කියලා. ඉතින් මට මේ තරුණ මන්ත්‍රීතුමා හැටියට ඔබතුමා ඉතාමත්ම හොඳ කාර්යභාරයක් මේ පහුගිය කාලෙදී මේ අපේ අරගලයට සම්බන්ධ වෙලා ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ ඒ යෝජනාවලිත් එක්ක මේ ඉදිරියට අපිට දිසාන තිකට ගමන් කරන්න පුළුවන් නම් අන්න ඒ වගේ හොඳ අදහස් තියෙන මන්ත්‍රීතුමා කෙනෙක් හැටියට ඉතාමත්ම අගය කරන ඔබතුමාගේ අදහස් දැක්වීම ඔබතුමා කිව්වා වගේම මම ප්‍රශ්නයකටත් වැඩිය මම මේ කතා කරන්නේ මේ ඇත්තටම මේ මූල හේතු වලට ආමන්ත්‍රණය කිරීමක් අපේ රටේ ඉතිහාසයේ දැන් මට අවුරුදු 59යි ඒ කාල සීමාව තුළ එහෙම ආමන්ත්‍රණයක් කරන්න අපේ සිංහල නායකයෝ සහ ඒ නායකාදී මේ වගේ කිව් යුතුයි උනන්දුවක් ඉන්නේ සහ අපේ කොච්චර සිවිල් සමාජයේ හැටියට අපි කොච්චර දැනුවත් කිරීම කරත් අපේ විවිධ සංවිධාන හරහා දැනුවත් කිරීම කරත් ඒ නිවැරදි හේතුවට හේතුව මේ හේතු මේ මූල හේතුව හොයලා ඒකට ආමන්ත්‍රණය කළේ ප්‍රශ්නයක් විසඳන්න අපේ සමාජය තුළ අපේ දේශපාලන නායකයන් සහ අපේ ඒකට අපේ පුරවැසියන්ගෙත් ලොකු වැරද්දක් තියෙනවා 10% වූ මේ පුරවැසි භූමිකාව තමයි ඇත්තටම අපේ හරි මේ සම්බන්ධ වෙලා තියෙන්නේ
I'd
like to just quickly just take 1 minute. There are two or three questions on the Q&A. I'll just take 1 or 2 minutes and I'll
yeah, yeah. Thank you, Mr. Dishanayake. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you very much for your comments. And bohom stuti obathumage karunu walata habai godak prashna thiyena man kemathi ekara wedagath prashnayak thiyena eke ekata man visheshayen pilithura denna kemathi. Man that's name is Mano. And the question is, why did TNA fail to have a tent in Gota Gogama for 100 days? Gota Gogama was a non-political struggle. There are no political parties involved. So the idea of TNA having a tent does not work well. But yes, there have been many Tamil people who have been involved educating of things that happened and through visuals and also verbal. And I think we are at a stage where the state needs to start educating the people, whereas when the TNA is not the one that should be educating, the state needs to educate people. And there is also another question about talking about from what is your thoughts and what will you be doing from your side to get the trust. We are talking about Aragale. 1983 as victim from 1983. I think it's to educate more Sinhala people. I don't believe that a single single Sinhala politician is not aware of the history. I think it's mostly the common man needs to be educated. And yes, and my efforts since I have been elected to parliament have been completely, mostly been focused on educating. Understand, and I think we have made some progress because you see that the Mulivaikal commemoration was done at Gold Face, so that is a huge leap in history, I would say. And Honorable Shanakyan, July 93 could be a blessing in disguise. Excellent thought. Would you see such wisdom could be accepted by the mainstream people and politicians? Well, it's always it's always a challenge. We are always trying to. If we don't feel that it's possible, then I might as well quit politics and look after my private life. So I feel to make this acceptable to the mainstream people is a task, and we should all join hands together to do that. So I think that's most of the questions that were there. If I've missed anything, maybe we can do it later. But thank you very much. Thank you very much for all the people who gave.
Thank you, Mr. Rasamanikam. I know there are several more who have raised their hands. but we have to move on. And at the end, during the discussion session, let us take those questions. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Mujibur Rahman. He's also a well-known member of parliament of Samagi Janabalavege for Colombo district. And the thing I could recollect is his party was attacked, I think, sometime last year, probably in Maligavatte. I remember
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yes.
And
the obvious things.
Many recognize him as one among the several members in the parliament who can stand up with a backbone. And I don't know, I mean, I'm not saying Mr. Razamanikam is not. He is also. And exactly. So all of them are not acting deaf, dumb and blind, because most of the members of parliament, we could say, they are selling their souls for pelt perks and portfolios. Let us welcome Mr. Rahman to the floor.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Lionel Bopage, for me to invite to this webinar. And at the same time, I prefer to do my presentation in Sinhala language. Stuti.
Give me a second, Mr. Rahman.
Yeah, of course.
Those who wish to listen to his speech in English or Tamil, please use the interpretation facility as I explained earlier. If you have a problem, please talk to Mr. Ranjit Singh. Thank you. Yeah, please go ahead, Mr. Rahman.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Lionel. Attatama then me asutune kalu Julia mahidana avurudu 39ak vena me avasthave api harila balanokota Mr. Lionel Bopage vistara kala wage rate ithihase purama kalu Julia ha sambandha eha samana siddhin me rate rasiyak siddha vela thibena. E wage ma math ithihase අපි ගත්තොත් මුස්ලිම් ප්‍රජාවට විරුද්ධව දිගන ඒ වගේම බේරුවල අලුත් ගම වගේ සිද්ධීන් ඇති වෙලා තිබෙනවා. දැන් තිබෙන ගැටලුව තමයි තවදුරටත් මේ රටේ ඊට ඉදිරියේදී මෙවැනි සිද්ධීන් වලට මේ අපේ රට ප්‍රජාව එහෙම නැත්නම් මේ රටේ ඉන්න ජනතාව මුහුණ දෙන්න වෙයිද කියන එක තමයි මම මතු කරන ප්‍රශ්නේ. මට තියෙන ප්‍රධානම ප්‍රශ්නේ තමයි දැන් මේ රටේ තිබෙන අපි ගත්තොත් මේ වාතාවරණය දැන් මේ තිබෙන අලුත් ආර්ථික අර්බුදය හා සමාජ දේශපාලන අර්බුදයත් එක්ක තිබෙලා තිබෙන තත්ත්වයත් එක්ක යම් කිසි ප්‍රමාණයකට එහෙම නැත්නම් විශාල ලෙස ජාතිවාදී ආගම්වාදී ව්‍යාපාර සියලු දේවල් අද වෙනකොට යටපත් වෙලා තිබෙනවා. ඒකට ඉදිරියේදී මේ රටේ මේ පාලකයන් නැවත වතාවක් මේ ව්‍යාපාර වලට කොයිතරම් දුරට මේවා Tamanගේ බලය ලබා ගැනීම සඳහා මේවා නැවත වතාවක් පාවිච්චි කරයිද කියන එක තවම කියන්න බෑ. කෙසේ වෙතත් ඉතිහාසයත් එක්ක බලනකොට මම දකින දේ තමයි විශේෂයෙන්ම අපි 48 නිදහස ලැබපු දවසේ ඉඳන් අපි රටේ පාලනය කරපු සියලුම දේශපාලන පක්ෂ ඒකේ නායකයෝ කවමදාකවත් මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ විසඳ ගන්න එහෙම යම් කිසි ආකාරයේ සාමූහික එකමුතුවක් එහෙම නැතුව සාමූහික උත්සාහයක් දරලා නැහැ. අපි 48 ඉඳන් මෑත ඉතිහාසයේ වෙනකන් ගත්තම ප්‍රධාන දේශපාලන පක්ෂවල හැම නායකයෙක්ම මේ ප්‍රශ්නය තමන්ට බලය ලබා ගැනීම සඳහා පාවිච්චි කරන එක තමයි අපි ඉතිහාස පුරාම අපි දැකලා තියෙන්නේ. ඒතකොට මේ ඉතිහාසයේ පුරාම අපි දැකලා විශේෂයෙන්ම අපි ඒ හරහා අවුරුදු 30කට 35කට වගේ ආසන්න කාලයකට විශාල යුද්ධයක් කරලා මේ යුද්ධය හරහා අපේ රටේ මානව සම්පත් මුදල් ඒ සියලු දේවල් අපි විනාශ කරමින් කොහොමhari අවසානයේ අපි යුද්ධය ජයග්‍රහණය කරා කියලා කියනවා. නමුත් මේ යුද්ධය ජයග්‍රහණය කරලා 2009න් පස්සේ අද වෙනකොට අවුරුදු 10කට 11කට කිට්ටු වෙන මේ කාලේ අපි අරගෙන බැලුවත් තවම අපි අපෝසත් වෙලා තියෙනවා රටක් හැරියට මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ විසඳ ගන්න. එතකොට ඇයි මේක විසඳ ගන්න බැරි වුණේ කියන එක තමයි ප්‍රශ්නේ. මටත් නොතේරෙන දෙයක් තමයි මේ රටේ ඉන්න මේ ප්‍රධාන දේශපාලන පක්ෂවල නායකයන් ඇයි Taman මේ අවුරුදු 35ක වගේ ඉතා බියුසුම යුද්ධයක් කරලා ඒ යුද්ධය අරහා විශාල ආර්ථික වශයෙන් අපි පරිහානියට ගියා. අපි ජාතීන් අතර බෙදීම් ඇති වුණා. විශාල ලෙස අපේ මානව සම්පත් නැති වුණා. අපේ රටේ හිටපු උගත් බුද්ධිමත් අය මේ රට දාලා ගියා. එවැනි විශාල අත්දැකීම් තියෙන රටක් හැටියට තවම එහෙම උත්සාහයක්වත් පේන්නේ නැහැ. නැවත වතාවක් මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ විසඳ ගන්න පුළුවන් ආකාරයේ තැනකට මේ රටේ ගිනේ. මට නම් එහෙම පේන්නේ නැහැ. අපි මේ තිබෙන ප්‍රධාන ප්‍රශ්නේ හැටියට අපි දකින මේ ජාතික ප්‍රශ්නය, ජාතීන් අතර එකමුතුව, සංහිඳියාව, ශ්‍රී ලාංකිකයන් හැටියට අපිට එකතු වෙලා වැඩ කරන්න ඕනේ කියන ඒ අදහස මේ ප්‍රධාන පක්ෂ නියෝජනය කරන බොහෝ ද මේ කියන්නේ සියලුම දෙනාම කියලා මට කියන්න බෑ. නමුත් බහුතරයකගේ තවම මේ මතය පේන්නේ නෑ මට. ඉතින් මට තේරෙන්නේ නැති ප්‍රශ්නේ තමයි හැමතිස්සෙම මම දේශපාලනිකව මතු කරන ප්‍රශ්නයකුත් තමයි, ඇයි මේක විසඳ ගන්න පුළුවන් වෙන්නේ දකුණෙන් එන බහුතරයෙන් පත්වෙන ඒ බහුතර ජනතාවගේ නායකයන්ට තමයි මේක විසඳ ගන්න පුළුවන් විශාල ඉඩකඩ ප්‍රමාණයක් තිබුණේ. නමුත් අපිට පේන දේ තමයි එම එවැනි බහුතර නායකයන් තවමත් මේ ප්‍රශ්නය තමන්ගේ දේශපාලන වාසියලා, තමන්ට දේශපාලන ව්‍යාපෘතියා බලය ලබා ගැනීමට පමණක් මේක පාවිච්චි කිරීම තුළ තවම අපිට කියන්න බෑ ඉදිරි කාලයේදීත් රට කොයි පැත්තකටද ගමන් කරයිද කියන එක. මොකද අපි පෞගේ කාල පුරාම අපි දෙකපු දේ තමයි විශේෂයෙන්ම අපේ රටේ විශේෂයෙන්ම 2015ට කලින් ඒ ඇතිවෙච්ච ආගම්වාදී ජාතිවාදී සුළු ජනකොටස් වලට විරුද්ධව එල්ල කරපු ඒ සියලු සංවිධාන රාජ්‍ය රජයේ විශේෂයෙන්ම උදව් මත රජයේ රාජ්‍ය අනුග්‍රහය මත හැදිච්ච ඒ මත වැඩ කරපු සංවිධාන කියන එක අපි සියලු දෙනාම ඒක දන්න. ඒක රටටත් පේන්න තිබුණා. ඉතින් ඒ හින්දා මෙවැනි මානසිකත්වයකින් පෙළෙන
Mr. Rahuman ke internet එක freeze වුණා මම හිතන්නේ. Mr. Rahuman ke internet connection එක freeze වුණා. මම කියන දේ ඇහෙනවද දන්නේ නැහැ. මම හිතන්නේ. අපි Mr. Rahuman ආපහු එකතු වුණාම මේ එයා කතාවට අවස්ථාව දෙමු. ඒ අතරේ අපි ප්‍රශ්න උත්තර වාරයකට යමු. We'll go for a Q&A session. Did missed what happened? Okay, he left.
Yes, Mr. Rahman left and then he might come back soon, I guess.
Yeah, let us see. Okay. Mr. Rahman.
Nice giant.
Microphone.
Microphone. Yeah.
Yes.
Sorry, can you hear
me? Yes. Continue. Yeah. Please continue.
Me?
You have to be
close. No, I had a small problem here. Me power cut take. Power cut. Power cut take. Hi, guy. Because of power cut, I lost my
okay.
connection.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, okay. Right. Yeah. So, India wage ratawal yam pramanaya kata puluwang una egolanta jathika prashne visindagena ratula sanghidiyawa balaya bedaga. අවාසනාවකට ඒක අපිට කරගන්න 48 නම් තව වෙනකන් අපි අපෝසත් වෙලා තියෙනවා. ඉතින් මම දකින්නේ අපිට 83 වෙන්න පුළුවන්, 83ට කලින් සිද්ධ වෙච්ච දේවල් වෙන්න පුළුවන්, 83ට පස්සේ දේවල් සිදු වෙච්ච දේවල් වෙන්න පුළුවන්. ඒ සිදුවීම් සියල්ල දිහා බැලුවම ඒවවල වෙච්ච ඒ සිද්ධි වලට වෙච්ච සිදුවීම් අඩු හෝ වැඩි ප්‍රමාණයක් වෙන්න පුළුවන්. නමුත් ඒ සියලු සිදුවීම් අපි දැක්කේ විශේෂයෙන්ම මේ රටේ ඉන්න දෙමළ ප්‍රජාව ඉලක්ක කරගනිමින්, ඒ වගේම මුස්ලිම් ප්‍රජාව ඉලක්ක කරගනිමින් යම් කිසි ආකාරයේ රාජ්‍ය අනුග්‍රහයත් එක්ක වෙච්ච සිදුවීම් හැටියට තමයි අපිට මේ සිදුවීම් පේන්න තියෙන්නේ. ඉතින් මම දකින දේ තමයි අනාගතය ගැන, විශේෂයෙන්ම අනාගතය ගැන මේවා නොවන ආකාරයේ අලුත් ව්‍යවස්ථාවක් බලය බෙදාගෙන ශ්‍රී ලාංකික අනන්‍යතාවය හදාගෙන විවිධත්වයේ තුල එක්සත්කම හදාගන්න පුළුවන් වැඩපිළිවෙලක් ඇතුලේ අපිට මේ තිබෙන රටේ තිබෙන මේ අලුත් සමාජ හා දේශපාලන වාතාවරණය හදාගෙන යන්න පුළුවන් නම් මම හිතනවා දැන් මෙතන අදහස් කරපු අදහස් දක්වපු ඒ සියලු දෙනාම බලාපොරොත්තු වෙන රටක් අපිට හදා ගන්න පුළුවන්. ඉතින් ඒකේ ලොකු වැඩ කොටසක් තිබෙනවා. විශේෂයෙන්ම අපේ රටේ තිබෙන දේශපාලන බලපොරොත්තුය බලය ලබා ගැනීම සඳහා මේ රටේ ඉන්න නායකයන් ඕනම දෙයක් කරන්න ලෑස්ති කියන එක පෞගේ කාලේ පුරාම උත්සාහ කරා. හොඳම දේ හොඳම නිදසුන තමයි මේ රටේ මේ පහුගිය ජූලි 9 වෙනිදා සිද්ධිය, මැයි 9 වෙනිදා සිද්ධිය. මේ රටේ මැයි 9 වෙනිදා පස්සේ තිබුණා බුදුමාලා සියලු දෙනාම දන්නව දවස් කීපයක් අඬුවක්. ජනාධිපතිතුමා විදිහේ අගමැතිතුමා නැහැ, කැබිනට් එකම කඩා වැටලා තිබුණා. ඒක එවැනි තත්ත්වයකදී පවා මේ රටේ ප්‍රධාන පක්ෂවල නායකයන්ට එකට වාඩි වෙලා මේ අර්බුදයේ විසඳා ගැනීම සඳහා ජනතාවගේ නැගිටගෙන ආපු ඒවුන් ඒ කියන දේවල් වලට ඇහුම්කන් දීලා රටේ දේශපාලන ප්‍රතිසංස්කරණ හා ඒ ඔවුන් කරන බලපෑම ඔවුන් අර්ථයක් මේක කියලා පිළිගෙන අඩුම තරමින් ඒ එතනටවත් අලු වෙන්න මේ
ඔඩියෝ එකට තව පොඩ්ඩක් කිට්ටු වුණ සමහරලාට මේ
හෙලෝ
ඔව් කියන්න
හෙලෝ
හරි කතා කරන්න
දැනනවද මම කියාගෙන හිටියේ මේ දකුණේ ඇති වෙච්ච මේ නැගිටීම හා මේ තරුණයන්ගේ හඬ පිළිබඳව මේ නායකයන් සංවේදී වෙන්නේ නැත්තම් ඔවුන් කියන දෙයට ඇහුම්කන් දෙන්නේ නැත්තම් මේ සමාජ අර්බුදයත් එක්ක ඇතිවෙච්ච මේ පිළිබඳව ඒගොල්ලන්ට හරියාකාරව ඇගෙයීමක් කරන්න හා ඒ පිළිබඳව යම්කිසි ආකාරයේ දේශපාලන කෝණයකින් බලලා ඒකට පිළිතුරු සපයන්න ලෑස්ති වා වෙනුවට මර්ධනයේ දියත් කරලා අමානුෂික ලෙස පහර දීලා මේවා යටපත් කරන්න උත්සාහ දරනවා නම් ඉතින් මම හිතන්නේ නෑ මේ නායකයන්ට පුළුවන් කියලා මේ රටේ ඉන්න සුළු ජන කොටස් වල තිබෙන අභිලාෂයන් හා ඔවුන් කියන දේවල් ගැන මේගොල්ලන්ට තේරෙයි කියලා. මොකද දකුණේ ඉන්න ජනතාව කියන දේම තේරෙන්නේ නැත්තම් අපි දැක්කා විශේෂයෙන්ම ජූනි 9 ඒ ඇතිවෙච්ච නැගිටීම විශේෂයෙන් මම කොළඹ නගරයේ ජීවත් කෙනෙක් හැටියට මම දැක්කා ලක්ෂ සංඛ්‍යාත ජනතාවක් එදා කෝචි නැතුව ප්‍රවාහන පාසුකම් නැතුව ඩීසල් නැතුව පෙට්‍රල් නැතුව තියෙද්දි ලක්ෂ සංඛ්‍යා ජනතාවක් කොළඹ නගරයට ඇදීගෙන ආවා. එයාපු ජනතාව සමහර අය දවස් ගණක් පයින් ඇවිදගෙන ආවා. එහෙම ඇවිල්ලා තමයි මේ තිබෙන සිස්ටම් එකට හා මේ දූෂිත දේශපාලඥයන්ට විරුද්ධව Tamanගේ විරෝධය පෑවේ. ඉතින් ඒක කොයිතරම් දුරට මේ සමාජයේ තුල මේක ඇති වෙලා මේ නැගිටීම ගැනවත් තේරුම් ගන්න බැරි නම් මේ නායකයෝ හිතනවා නම් මේ නැගිටීම මෙහෙම ගහලා මර්ධනය කරන්න පුළුවන් කියලා. ඉතින් මට හිතන දේ තමයි ඉතින් මේ Taman එක්ක ඉන්න මිනිස්සුන්ගේ ප්‍රශ්නවලටම මේගොල්ලෝ සංවේදී නොවෙන්නව නම් අනිකුත් ජන කොටස් වල ප්‍රශ්න පිළිබඳව මේගොල්ලෝ කොහෙද සංවේදී වෙන්නේ කියන එක තමයි මට තියෙන බය හා ගැටලුව ඉදිරි අනාගතයේ ගැන. ඉතින් මං හිතනවා දේශපාලඥයෙක් හැටියට ඒ වගේම සිවිල් ක්‍රියාකාරීන් හැටියට ඔබ සියලු දෙනාම පිටරටවල හිටියත් සියලු දෙනාටම වගකීමක් තිබෙනවා. කොහොම හරි මේ රට හරි මගකට හා හරි තැනට තල්ලු කරගන්න පුළුවන් උත්සාහයක් අපි සියලු දෙනාමට ඒ වගකීම තියෙනවායි කියලා. ඉතින් මං හිතනවා මගේ කාලය තුලදී මම ඉතා කෙටියෙන් දේශපාලනිකව මේ කරුණු අතු කරේ. මට අවශ්‍ය වෙලා තිබුණේ සිද්ධීන් අපි සියලු දෙනාම දන්නවා 87 ගැන 83 දන්නවා 56 දන්නවා 58 දන්නවා 63 දන්නවා 77 දන්නවා 81 83 2018 2014 ඒ සියලු සිද්ධීන් අපි ඕන තරම් විවාදවලදී සාකච්ඡාවලදී අපි මේවා ගැන කතා කරලා තියෙනවා. නමුත් දැන් අපිට ඕමනා වෙන්නේ ඉදිරි අනාගතයේ කොහොමද හදාගන්නේ මේ බහුතර සමාජයේ තුල මේ රටේ ජීවත් වෙන සුළු ජන කොටස් වල තිබෙන අභිලාෂයන් හා බලාපොරොත්තු වා ඔවුන්ගේ කටයුතු ගැන ඒ බහුතර සමාජයේ දැනුවත් වෙලා සියලු දෙනාටම ශ්‍රී ලාංකිකයන් හැටියට මේ සමානතාවයේ උඩ එක රටක් තුල විවිධත්වයේ එක ජීවත් වෙන මුලම් රටක් හදාගන්නේ කොහොමද කියන එක තමයි තියෙන ගැටලුව. අපි සියලු දෙනාම නැවත වතාවක් අර ගෝත්‍රවාදී මානසිකත්වයට තමයි අපි ගමන් කරන්නේ. එහෙනම් ඒකෙන් මිදෙන්න අපි සියලු දෙනාටම විශාල කාර්යභාරයකුත් තියෙනවා කරන්න. ඉතින් මම මේ සාකච්ඡාව තුළ මට මතු කරන්න හා මම විස්තර කරන්න සූදානම් වෙලා හිටියෙත් මේ ප්‍රධාන කරුණු ගැන අපේ අනාගතය ගැන අපි කොහොමද ගතින් හෙලෝ හෙලෝ
කියන් පොඩ්ඩක් ඉන්ටර්නෙට් එක ඩිස්ටර්බ් වුණා නමුත්
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
මම කියාගෙන හිටියේ විශේෂයෙන්ම දැන් මේ තිබෙන ඉදිරි අනාගතය ගැන අපිට විශාල වගකීමක් තිබෙනවා සිවිල් සංවිධාන සිවිල් Hello, can you hear me?
අපි අවසන් කරමු මිස්ටර් රහමාන්. මේ ලයින් එක disturb වෙනවා. මම මේ විනාඩි 10ක් මේ ප්‍රශ්න වලට උත්තර දෙනවා. I will yeah. Thank you very much Mr. Rahman. Anybody who wants to post questions, they could
hurry, hands hurry.
Now. And I saw Comrade Renuka Maliyagoda wanted to ask a question. Are you still interested in asking the question? Renuka? I can't see her now. Renuka Maliyagoda? And just going to the okay, yeah, I will allow you to talk. Give me a second. Renuka Saudri, kata karana mic ekak unmute karala.
Oh, mata mama kiyanna kemathi mama mahanuwarin kata karanne Lankawe. Mata thiyena prashne tamai dan me parliament mantriwaru dedenek metana සම්බන්ධ වෙලා ඉන්නවා අපිට. නමුත් මේ ඉතිහාසයේ පුරාවට කිසිම දේශපාලන පක්ෂයක් මේ ප්‍රශ්නෙට නිවැරදිව ආමන්ත්‍රණය කරලා නැහැ. මේ සුළු ජාතීන්ගේ ප්‍රශ්න වලට මම කැමති නැහැ වචනේ පාවිච්චි කරන්න. දමිළ සහ මුස්ලිම් ප්‍රජාවගේ ප්‍රශ්න වලට. ඔවුන්ට තියෙනවා වතුකරේ ගත්තාම තියෙනවා මේ මිනිසුන්ට උප්පැන්න සහතිකයක් නැහැ. මේ මිනිස්සු වැඩ කරපුවාම මේ මිනිසුන්ගේ ෆන්ඩ්ස් ගන්න විදියක් නැහැ. ඒගොල්ලන්ට ඩෙන්ටි කාඩ් එකක් නැහැ. කිසිම කෙනෙක් මේ පිළිබඳ අවධානය යොමු කරන්නේ නැහැ. මට ඇහිලා නැහැ පාර්ලිමේන්තුවේ මේ පිළිබඳව කතා කරනවා. ඊළඟ කාරණාව තමා ඒ අපි මේ ළඟදි ගියා උතුරට සංචාරයක් මං හිතන්නේ නවරත්න බණ්ඩ සහෝදරයත් මේකේ ඉන්නවා මේ Zoom meeting එකේ. නමුත් ඒගොල්ලෝ කියන්නේ අපේ ඕගොල්ලෝ දැන් මේ අවුරුදු 40ක් අත්විඳ ප්‍රශ්නයක් ඔයාලා දැන් මේ කතා කරනවා කියලා. ඇයි ඔය පාර්ලිමේන්තුවට බැරි වුණේ ප්‍රශ්න විසඳන්න? අඩුම තරමේ ඒ අතුරුදහන් වූවන්ට තමන්ගේ ආගම අනුව තමන්ගේ අවසන් කටයුතු කරගන්න තමන්ගේ ඥාතියගේ තමන්ගේ දරුවගේ තමන්ගේ මහත්තයාගේ ඒ අවසන් කටයුතු ටික කරගන්න අද වෙනතුරු බැරි වෙලා තියෙනවා ඒගොල්ලන්ට මරණ සහතිකයක් නිකුත් කරන්න. ඒ වගේම තමයි අතුරුදහන් වූවන්ට මොකද වුණේ කියලා බලන්න. හිරේ විලංගුවේ වැටලා ඉන්න මිනිස්සුන්ව නිදහස් කරන්න. ඒගොල්ලෝ බලන්නේ පාර්ලිමේන්තුවේ ඉන්න මන්ත්‍රීලා ඇමතිලා බලන්නේ තමන්ගේ බලය රැකගන්න. මම මේ චෝදනාව කෙලින්ම කරනවා. ඒකට හොඳම කාරණාව තමයි තමන්ගේ ජාතිය ප්‍රශ්නවත් තමන් විසඳ ගන්න උත්සාහ කරන්නේ නැහැ පාර්ලිමේන්තුවට ගියාට. තමන් බලන්නේ තමන්ගේ වැටුප සහ අවුරුදු 5කට පස්සේ හම්බෙන පෙන්ෂන් එක ගැන විතරයි. තරමක් හෝ මේ දෙන්න ගැන අපිට සතුටු වෙන්න පුළුවන් ඔවුන් තරමක් හෝ මේ ප්‍රශ්න ගැන කතා කරන නිසා. නමුත් අතීතයේ අපේ අධ්‍යක්ෂ ඒ අප්‍රසන්න සිදුවීම් පාර්ලිමේන්තුව තුළ මේගොල්ලෝ කතා කරනවා වෙනුවට මේගොල්ලෝ කරන්නේ අපේ සිතුම් පැතුම් එක්ක සෙල්ලම් කරනවා පාර්ලිමේන්තුවට ගිහිල්ලා. කෝටි ගාණක් අපේ සල්ලි නැති කරනවා. පෞගිය කාලයේ පුරාවට මෙයාලට බැරි වුණා එක මේසෙකට ඇවිල්ලා මේ ප්‍රශ්නෙට විසඳුමක් හොයන්න. අතන ගෝල් ෆේස් එකේ තරුණ දරුවෝ මැරෙනවා. කවුද මේවට වග කියන්නේ? කවුද ඒ දරුවන්ගේ ජීවිතවලට වග කියන්නේ? කාගේ වුණත් දරුවෙක් තමයි එතන නැති වෙන්නේ. තමන් දෙමව්පියන්ට ඒ වේදනාව තියෙනවා ඒ දරුවන්ගේ අයිතිකාරයින්ට. ඒ වගේම තමයි ඒ වේදනාව අපිටත් දැනෙනවා. මම පාසල් යන කාලේ මම දැක්කා මම මගේ අප්පච්චි ආවා මාව එක්කන් යන පාසලට ඔය දෙමළ කෝලාහල තියෙන පවතින කාලේ. ඒ යනකොට මම දැක්කා අහිංසක දුප්පත් දෙමළ මිනිස්සෙක් බත් එකක් කනවා දිග අරගෙන. පොලිස්කාරයෙක් ඇවිල්ලා ඒ මිනිස්සයාට පයින් ගැහුවා. එදා ඉඳලා මගේ ජීවිතේ පොලිසිය සහ හමුදාව කියන එක පිළිබඳව පුදුම අප්‍රසන්න සිදුවීමක් තියෙනවා. අද මේ කරපු දේ අපි එදා සිකුරාදා පාන්දර දැක්ක දේ. එහෙමනම් ඒ යුද්ධයේ වෙලාවේ මොන තරමක් ඒ උතුරු නැගෙනහිර පුද්ගලයින්ට අත් වෙන්න ඇද්ද? ඒ දරුවන්ට අත් වෙන්න ඇද්ද? ඒ කාන්තාවන් මොන තරම් ක්‍රූරත්වයට පත් වෙන්න ඇද්ද? කවුද මේවා ගැන කතා කරන්නේ? කිසිම කෙනෙක් නෑ මේ පාර්ලිමේන්තුවේ. ඔවුන් කරන්නේ තමන්ගේ බලය රැකගන්න අපේ සිතුම් පැතුම් අපේ බලාපොරොත්තු එක්ක මේ අවුරුදු ගණනාවක් මේගොල්ලෝ විහිළු කරා. හැබැයි මම මේ පාර්ලිමේන්තුවට කියන ඔබ පුළුවන් නම් මේ දේ පාර්ලිමේන්තුවට ගෙනියන්න. ගමට එන්න එපා ඡන්දෙ ඉල්ලන්න. හොඳට මතක තියාගන්න. ගමට එන්න එපා ඡන්දෙ ඉල්ලන්න. බොහොම ස්තුතියි.
බොහොම ස්තුතියි සහෝදරි. මිස්ටර් මන්සූර් නැති නිසා මිස්ටර් රහමාන් නැති නිසා is there anybody else who would like to respond?
මම ශානකයෙන් කතා කරන්නේ. මගේ පවර් එක නැහැ. ඒක නිසා මම මේ වීඩියෝ එක ඔෆ් කරන්නේ. ක්වලිටි එක නැත්තම් මදි නිසා මටත් ඉලෙක්ට්‍රිසිටි කට් එකක් ගියා නිසා. ඇත්තටම මේ මම සතුටුයි. මම කිව්වා වගේම මේ අපේ පක්ෂය ගත්තා නම් මං හිතන අපේ පක්ෂයේ දෙමළ ජාතික සන්ධානයේ කවදාවත් අමාත්‍යංශ අරගෙනත් නැහැ. අපි දිගටම අපේ ජනතාවගේ ගැටලු තමයි निराකරණය කරන්න උත්සාහ කරන්නේ. ඉතින් ඒ අතුරුදහන් වෙච්ච පුද්ගලයන්ගේ ගැටලු, ඒ වගේම දේශපාලන සිරකරුවන් ගැටලු, මේ වගේ ෆෝරම්ස් තව තවත් ඇති වෙන්න ඕනේ. මොකද මං කිව්වේ මට ඉතාම සතුටුයි මම කියන්න ඕන කරුණු තව මෙතන සිංහලෙන් මජොරිටි කමියුනිටි එකෙක් කියන එක මට සතුටුයි. ඉතින් ඒක නිසා මේ වගේ සාකච්ඡා තවදුරටත් කෙරෙන්න ඕනේ. නවරත්න බණ්ඩ මහත්මයා වගේ මහත්මරු ඉතින් දිගටම මේ වගේ උනන්දුවෙන් වැඩ කරනවා. හැබැයි අපි මේ උනන්දු වෙලා වැඩ කරන මේ කණ්ඩායම තවත් පුළුල් කරගන්න ඕනේ. මාත් එක්කත් වැඩ කරන කණ්ඩායම් ගොඩක් ඉන්නවා. අපි මේ කණ්ඩායම් තව තවත් පුළුල් කරගන්න ඕනේ. වැඩි පිරිසක් මේ වගේ සංවාද කරලා මේ රටේ ජනතාව දැනුවත් කරන්න කියන තමයි මගේ මතය. ඒකට
බොහොම ස්තුතියි. Thank you very much, Mr. Rasamanik. I will allow Ravindranath Vijayanathan. No, sorry. Give me a second. Mr. Ravindranath.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I would like to, actually, I was trying to pose this question to Mr. Mujibur Rahman. Since he's not there, I have another question to Mr. Sanakyan. My question is mostly directed to, the issues in the north, mainly if you see what happened in the south, the Bar Association was very much supportive of this situation. But when you look back in what happens in the north, none of the Bar Association's people never came and spoke up, which if they came and spoke up, there would have been a lot of weight to that. And basically, even the judiciary would have been very firm. But however, it never happened there. What is your opinion on that, Mr. Rasamanikam?
I wouldn't say that because I would like to give an example. I was issued an order by the magistrate in Kalavanchikudi in Batiklo prohibiting me from participating. It was an order that was given to prohibit me from participating in any protests for a period of 14 days. It didn't directly say I can't participate, but it said that that any public nuisance that it may cause, such as blocking the road, could lead to my arrest, so that I was prohibited from, you know, participating. So during that time, the president of the Bar Association, I thanked him, and I need to say that as well. Salia Pieris spoke to me, and you know, the entire bar appeared, and Bar Association also made representations on my behalf. So I think the Bar Association has been very active, trying to do their best even in the East. And in terms of North also, I think the president of the Bar Association is always in touch with us on things that need to be done. But I think it got a lot of more publicity in Colombo. It's not the same as 100 lawyers marching down in Colombo. So that is probably why it didn't seem like they were very, very active in the North and the East.
Thank you, Mr. Chanakya. Now, we have exceeded the 10 minutes. Now it is time for the discussion session. So we will continue it as, you know, whatever the questions you have to go. So I know there have been many hands raised here. If everybody could stay half an hour more, that means, you know, we will have another around, say, 20, 30, 50 minutes. So I think basically we would be able to cover almost all questions. So I will go by the hands raised because I can't find the order in which those hands are raised. I will go one by one, starting from the top from the top of the list. I will allow Mr. Jayasri Priyalal to talk. No, sorry, something is playing up. Mr. Jayasri Priyalal.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, right. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to share my insight. Let me first thank the three speakers who shared their insights. And I'm very happy listening to the two young parliamentarians who just shared their views. Well, I'm Priyalal. I'm staying in Singapore, but I have witnessed the 1983 riots on streets. And I was also there at the Aragalia Bhumi on 9th May, and I was also there on 9th July. So I witnessed all those things, and I'm really impressed. And what I want to share with you, I think the lady who spoke from Kandy, she really touched with the points that we are really trying to put in together to address the future of our country. Now, what I want to share with you, we have to think outside boxes, and we have to confine ourselves to the new way of living. The people who have come to the struggles, Aragalaya Bhumiya, they were motivated by the digital technology. These millennials, yes, they do not know much about the history, but they are really geared towards the future. I have seen people from all communities rallying together. I have been in the Aragalaya movement. I have associated with them. And I was in the front lines when they broke to get into the president's residence. So what I'm trying to say is, our political system, whether it is for the minorities, sorry, for the Tamils or Muslims or Sinhalese, is not working because our politicians are not directly accountable to the electorate nor to the taxpayers. Unless and until we bring that into order, whether it is for the minorities or whether it's for the majorities, the same political system will continue enhancing their entitlements and perks without addressing the problems of the common man on the street. So we must think of a system with, depending on the digital technology, all these analog era systems in administration, wasteful parallel administrations has to be completely removed from our systems. We have to come up with a new system that will make all people's representatives directly accountable to the taxpayers and to the electorate. Now what happens? Everybody is thinking of their entitlements and perks because it comes from a consolidated fund. So as long as our handa athe tiyaganna puluwan nan ona wedakata minis okkoma ekathu wenne anne minihat ekka pidipas yanne mokada tamunge varaprasad dinaganna anik miniha gana hitana de gana eka nisa api kalaana roopa wenas wenna ona meka sanda api nava taakshane pawachchi karanta ona me nava taakshane uda tamai ada me aragala bhumiye inne kello kollo okkoma ekathu wela inne ekinda garu mantri tuman latat me samaj sangwada api thawa digata karagena yanta ona apita womana karana system eka apima nirmanaya karaganta ona apita bala poruthu wenna ba me inna ape parliamentuwe inna boho denakuta e pilibanda avabodayak thiyenoda kiyala e katti ara parana achchuwe indamma thamai hitanda yanne e kattiyata me idiri gamana yanda ba ape taruna taruniyanta rata athule inna rata ratin pita inna මේ රටට ආදරය කරන බොහෝ දෙනෙක් ඉන්නවා. ඒ අය විවිධ ජාතිනේ අපිට විවිධත්වයේ තියන අයගේ ඒ හැකියාවන් රට තුලට ගේන්න පුළුවන්. මේක තමයි අවස්ථාව. අපි හදිසි වෙන්නේ නැතුව මේ තියෙන තත්ත්වයන් නැවිගේට් කරගෙන ඉස්සරහට යන් කියන අදහස් තමයි මට කියන්න තියෙන. බොහොම ස්තුතියි.
බොහොම ස්තුතියි Mr. Pilal. I will consider this at that as a comment. Could I go to Nalini? I will allow Nalini to talk. Please be brief because
thank you. I'm Nalini. I'm from Batticolo. Thank you so much for organizing this webinar. It's very fruitful and very constructive. Thank you for all the panelists who were presented well. My questions for all of us, including me, along with the gentleman who spoke before me, the problem, since we see in this country the parliamentary democratic system and the electoral system in Sri Lanka, if you are not rich, if you are not influential, you can't enter into politics. You can't go to parliament because you need money, because in the for election campaign, at least now presently in Batticolo, minimum you need to have 1 crore. If you don't have a money, you can't contest in the, and all the parties, regardless of ethnicity or religion, they will ask first, do you have money for campaign? If I say no, I can't get into the nomination list. When everybody, that's where family politics comes, influential people and business people. Jayawardena, Rajapaksa, Bandaranaike, all family politics, even Rasamanika, they come from a political family, also with the people elite and rich. When they come to parliament, when they come to politics, they see how to earn money. This is Bāshana was talking about the history, how the violence and all state all the time, 1915 1958 and 63 all 71 80, everything what's happening. Politics in Sri Lanka or in South Asia is a good profitable business. They can invest racism and religious extremism to earn more money. So this system and this culture need to change. Until and unless this system is changed, we cannot have politicians to address the root cause of the country. Nobody will think about the nation building. You know, now we have gone backwards since, you know, taking the IMF loan, and they are putting in trouble. And we all, every time, I think this Ravindranath gentleman was asking, Bar Association was kept quiet during the 40 years. They didn't come forward. Yes. Why? Because the racism. When they open mouth for Tamil people, Sinhala in South, they would say, you are tiger. So because of that, they kept quiet. Now they're active. This is good. Maybe they changed. But this situation we didn't see in the past. What I'm saying is politics is business, Sri Lanka, and racism is a profitable investment for all of them. Even Tamil Party or Muslim, when election campaign based on racism and religious extremism and regionalism. Batiklo people attack the Jaffna people, Jaffna attack the Batiklo people. They were thinking, who will be our leader? We don't want Jaffna leader to Batiklo Tamil people. This is I see in all the election campaigns. So this is our problem. We need to address this. We need to change our setup. And we need to, you know, for an example, if anybody comes from Aragalaya tomorrow, all the political parties, whoever they want to contest, they will see whether they have money. They have from the rich family. Then only they'll get nomination. This system has to change. How do we address these things before we talk about anything? Unless and until this change, we cannot, you know, country can't move forward. Rather, we will go backward. Thank you for opportunity.
Thank you. It was full of comments. Is there anybody who wants to respond very briefly to that?
Thank you, Nalini Akka. This is Shana Kien. Nalini Akka is a very close friend of mine as well.
Okay.
In fact, there is some element of truth to everything that she said, but I'm not trying to whitewash my party, but even Nalini Akka's name was considered for nominations in the 2020 parliament election. So our party is not, I wouldn't fully agree if on her comments about only people with money can contest under the Ilangai Tamil Arasa Katchi. But it is true though that it is a huge expenditure because during an election campaign, you know, just to get your party symbol and your preferential number out is a very expensive process, especially you're not allowed to permit, you're legally not allowed to put up posters or banners, and then the only way that is that you can do that is through if legally you can only do it through newspapers and TV advertisements and social media paid advertisements, and all of these things cost a lot of money. So it is, I think it is the same case around the world, but only thing is that some countries have campaign finance raising. They publicly raise funds for campaigns, but in Sri Lanka, you see, this is mostly with the main political parties that, you know, business people fund campaigns because then they get favors done when the candidate gets into a cabinet portfolio. So it's a bit different in the north and the east, especially with my party. But yes, some members of the government party even used job applications as a way of securing votes. There is an MP who got elected from Jaffna and Batiklo, who both, there are allegations saying that there are 20,000 job application forms were filled out before the election, promising jobs if they won. So yes, we need to seriously look at our electoral system as well. I agree with her on that.
Thank you, Mr. Osman. I will allow Nirmala to talk. Nirmala Raj Singh.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And thanks for the speakers and this event. Yes, I just want to refer to Bāshana's excellent speech. And I want to make a few comments regarding that. One is that I think the whole problem is that we have to interrogate the whole notion of nationalism, the nation state. All these concepts were bestowed upon us by colonialism, by 19th century Europe. And we have simply absorbed them as we did many other things from Europe, unquestioningly. We have to first admit that the Sri Lankan state, we have to define its character, is a Sinhala Buddhist nationalist state. Nationalism, Sinhala Buddhist nationalism, is a core organizing principle of the state. And I do not mean the state in a very narrow sense. I mean it in a very broad sense of how all kinds of attendant structures buttress it and keep it going. The media, the clergy, all kinds of power structures are holding it up. And that is a singular Buddhist nationalist state. And the organizing principle is nationalism. And what do we do on a practical day-to-day level of dealing with this? Because singular Buddhist nationalism has permeated throughout singular society. And I will come to it's the responses to it amongst the minority communities very brief, very quickly. And it's very similar. And this nationalist poison, how do we divest the state of this? And that can only happen through progressive struggles like the Aragalia at the moment, where I think the conversation about this toxic nationalism has begun, albeit in a very, very tiny way. It's opened up. And Bāshana talked about historical literacy. I mean, I was listening to some sort of singular bourgeois people, mainly middle classes. The singular middle classes are big culprits here. I mean, I know that ordinary people, poor people were galvanized to go and commit mob violence, etc., in various parts in 93, various times, and subsequently in Digana and Aluthama and every time. But the singular middle classes, the kind of amnesia they have, they will immediately tell you, like, I mean, I'm tolerated in some of these groups because I'm also very, very critical of the LTTE, the Tamil nationalism of the LTTE. So they tolerate me and believe me, the discussions in these groups are pretty disgusting because they want to forget the past and they don't want to do anything about it. And how do we, and we must find a force apart from the progressive struggles within in the Aragalia that will challenge nationalist thinking in so many ways that are not necessarily about, the lots of internal detail within this nationalist ideology that oppresses various sections of society, not just the minorities, within the singular polity. And we have to identify those and challenge those questions. For instance, women, singular women, or marginalized communities within the singular polity. And this whole story about the army being our saviors, I mean, this has been trotted out. Maybe we should make it compulsory reading. I'm just pointing out one massacre, the Chatrukondan massacre, the Eastern University massacre, where 48 people in the first few villages and then another 158 were just marched off and by firing squad or by hacking people to death happened. Chanakyan might remember that he wouldn't have been born then, or maybe he was a toddler. I don't remember the date, but you can go to the UTHR reports who have given a very clear, that should be compulsory reading of how this army behaved. It matches the horror of any Nazi Germany firing squads of Jewish people.
Nirmala, I would appreciate if you could be brief. Yeah, thank you.
Yes, so it's this nationalism and the counter-nationalism. I know how difficult it is because what Tamils have come to understand or believe is that the Sinhalese are a perfidious people. They are incapable of remorse. They are incapable of, so, you know, it's all laid at the feet of the Sinhala people. So that likewise, this nationalism, this seesaw, mirror each other and, you know, it just spirals out of control. And, you know, and that is what produced the Katankudi mosque massacre of some 149 people. I mean, we must understand the mechanics of these nationalisms. And there is no end to it. And nationalism has to be interrogated. And progressive Sinhalese, we cannot simply talk about things in an isolated fashion. The army is bad. The armies are bad everywhere. The armies are bad. The British army at the end of Second World War went out and raped German women. Yes, armies are bad. Armies are trained to be murderers. And we have to drum that into the heads of our people. They are not saviors. But it comes from nationalist thinking. And we have to start interrogating this. That's my contribution. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you. Comrade Bāshana, would you like to make a comment or take it as a comment?
Very briefly. There's no pointed question, I think. I mean, thank you, Nirmala, for the generous comment. And one thing I just want to add is actually, because she mentioned about Satrukondan massacre, which happened in September 1990, which is, I mean, quite important, because actually 1 year before that, now this happened on the, as far as I remember, it was like 9th or 10th of September 1990, where 184 or 85 people died. I mean, they were killed. I mean, like exactly 1 year late before, on September 13th and 15th of September 1989, the army and the police surrounded four villages in the central province Kandy, Mahavatta, Kundasale, Arangala, and Manikinna. And they took away 153, I mean, they took away, I don't know how many people they took away, but they killed 153 people. And 88 bodies are found because they were lying beside the roads. And some people say the rest were actually thrown to the river, which people have seen floating. And I mean, how many in the South remember that there had been such a massacre in 1989, September 13th and 15th, 2 days, 153 people died by the straight armed forces. So the important thing is actually our whole glorified idea about our collective past, the Sinhalese, I mean, nobody knows actually the history of this idea. Nobody knows how old is the idea we have about our past. And it is not older than 200 years. The way we started thinking about our collective past, the Mahavamsa-centric kind of historiographic kind of understanding, it came in the 19th century because of the British historians. So what I wanted to say is actually, we are trapped in history because actually history was made to trap us. And we have been trapped for too long in this distorted and history that basically put one against the other. And also basically provide the main reason for us to forget the history. Because, I mean, someone put a question on the Q&A asking why Sinhala people do not have a memory about the atrocities committed against the Tamils. So simply, if I were to answer that question in a more simple manner, the Sinhalese don't even remember what happened in 1990 September in these four villages in Kandy. It's not like everybody remembers about, you know, Ravana's time, Dutukamanu's time, Parakram Bahu's time, but nobody remembers about what happened in September 1989 or before that. You know, there were so many incidents. And the reason is, if we want to preserve that collective memory, what happened 30 years ago, we can't support a war against the Tamil people. We can't justify the atrocities committed against the Muslims, because that basically create a kind of dilemma for us. Because if we are going to say that the military carried out these kind of atrocities against the Sinhalese in that particular time, then that basically confirms the fact the state is criminal and the military has been carrying out criminal acts on behalf of the state. And as soon as we confirm that, Sinhalese believe that it can help the others to prove their points. The Tamil can come up with the war crimes accusations, and the Muslims can also put up accusations against the Sri Lankan army. So that basically betray our heroes. So this dilemma, basically, because normally denial is from, I mean, denial comes, I mean, about atrocities committed to others. But in order to do that, we as Sinhalese, we deny our own past. We deny the fact, because it's introverted denial. We basically try to deny this happened to us, because we want to basically say we didn't do this to others. Because if we say that this happened to us, then it indirectly confirms the state is criminal and the atrocities committed by the state armed forces is real. And in order to prevent that from happening, we basically take the easy path, and we it's not only turning our back to the victims of the Tamil community, Tamil people and the Muslim people, we turn our back to the Sinhala victims who died brutal deaths, who were tortured to death in hundreds of torture camps in the southern part of the country. And this is it's not simply a political problem, it's a moral dilemma that the Sinhalese are facing. Actually, just a comment I just want to add to that.
Thank you, comrade. I will move on from those who have raised hands to the Facebook page. There are two questions, so I will just I will go to those two questions, and anybody who would like to briefly answer, that will be good. Sarath Maddumage from Facebook.
අරගලයේ තරුණ ජනයා ආණ්ඩුවේ ආරක්ෂක හමුදා රණවිරුවන් ලෙස උත්කර්ෂයට නැගීම මෙම රාජ්‍ය ත්‍රස්තවාදය හඳුනා ගැනීම අපහසු කරනවා නේද? So, this one. Then, from Facebook itself, Jayakrishnan Raja Gopal Sharma, I do feel there is a big part played by media and journalists over the past four decades, where Tamil media and Sinhala media have two totally different faces of the same facts. Any comments or suggestions on the way forward for Tamil Sinhala youth on the above? If anybody wants to make comment on those two aspects. No. Comrade Bāshana, we can't hear you.
Mama, ketiyen kiyanna mama sarasawara mathuka sarasawara puggulika dannya sahodare eya mathu kala thina karanawa ekena eka etta gattuwak eka me sampurna satan aragala udghoshana vyapare virodhata vyapare diya balan innakota peena de thamai kendriya gattuwak widiyata thiyena me prashne attatama eka yanne da hamudawata iye gahana kotat mata ekak kene kiya hata gala kiyana ya kiwwa kiyala gahana kota pirinama ekkinwa kiyala mage me athara mahun dala thiyena mahun 17ak dala thiyenne eka nisa me athara gahanna epa gahanwa nan me ayye kondara gahanna kiyala එකන පළවෙනි කාරණා තමයි කොහොමද ආණ්ඩු විරෝධී අරගලයක් කරන්නේ හමුදාවන්ට පහර දෙන්න ඕන තැන කිය කිය. හරි ඒ ගැටලු එන්නේ මම කියන්නේ තනි පුද්ගලයෙක්ගේ ප්‍රශ්නයක් විදිහට නෑ මම මේ කියන්නේ. ඒක ඇවිල්ලා අපි ඉන්න අර රාජ්‍ය පිළිබඳවයි රාජ්‍ය හමුදා පිළිබඳවයි අපිව හිර කරලා තියෙන දෘෂ්ටිවාදී කුරු බිලියක් වගේ එකක්. ඒක නිකන් දෘෂ්ටිවාදී බිංගයක්. ඒකෙන් එළියට එන්න අපිට බෑ. ඒක නිසා අපි උත්සාහ කරනවා අර ලස්සන ටිකක් කෙනෙක් කියලා තිබ්බා මේ අරගලයේ තියෙන ප්‍රධාන ගැටලුවක් තමයි කියලා මේකේ ගොඩක් අයට ගල්ලෙන බින්දින්න ඕනේ නැහැ කියලා සිංහය මාරු කරගන්න ඕනේ කියලා. ඉතින් ගල්ලෙන බින්දින්න අදිෂ්ඨානයක් හෝ දේශපාලන අභිලාෂයක් නැතිනම් ගල්ලෙනට අලුතෙන් සිංහයෙක් ගැනීම තමයි විකල්පය. ඉතින් ඒක නිසා එයාගේ ඒක නා ලියලා තිනවා මේ අවශ්‍ය වෙලා තින්නේ ගල්ලෙන බින්දින්න පුළුවන් සිංහබහුව කෙනෙක් මිසක් තව සිංහයෙක් නෙමෙයි කියලා. එහෙනම් මේක මේ සිංහලයට තීරණ භාෂාවෙන් එයා කියලා තින්නේ. ඉතින් මම හිතන්නේ මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ ඔය රණවීර සංකල්පය පිළිබඳ ගැටලුව ඒක ඇවිල්ලා අපි තියෙන දෘෂ්ටිවාදී උගුල් අපි ඉන්න දෘෂ්ටිවාදී තරුණ පරම්පරාවල් විශේෂයෙන් මේගොල්ලන් ඒ උගුලට ඒගොල්ලන් ඒ කියන්නේ ඒගොල්ලෝ විහිං හදාගත්තා අපි හදලා ඒගොල්ලෝ ඒක ඇස්සේ හිර කරලා තියෙනවා. ඉතින් ඒක නිසා ඒකට විරුද්ධව හිතා ගන්න බැරි කමක් තියෙනවා.
දෙවෙනි
question about the second question. I mean the, it's I mean I can basically I mean the only thing I can do is I can totally agree with what Mr. Jayakrishnan has said basically. Because that is one of the fundamental questions. I have been, I mean, jokingly say, I mean, been saying this for a long time. If we didn't have media in Sri Lanka, much things would have been much better, actually. I mean, it's a kind of cynical statement, but I think it has a certain truth in it when you basically observe and analyze the content of the media. And I'm mostly talking about the Sinhala and English media because my Tamil knowledge is quite limited, actually. And this particular fact, for example, if you know, we don't have to go into the history, but if we take the example of Dr. Shafi, the way the media behaved and the way it was completely, he was demonized, vilified, and, you know, hounded throughout his whole family. And the same thing happened in 1996-97, when a Tamil assistant labor commissioner was arrested in Narahampeta, called Mr. Dharmalingam, I mean, falsely accusing him for hiding bombs, which he wanted to place in the schools in Colombo. Now, this happened in 1996, actually. Interestingly, this whole media narrative about a Tamil garment servant coming to Colombo, pretending to be a garment officer, but at the same time bringing bombs and hiding it in a temple in Narahampeta to place in schools. Actually, this whole narrative coincided with bombing Nagarkovil Central College in 1996 September, where school kids died because the Sri Lankan Air Force bombed the school. Now, this is basically, I mean, while the Sri Lankan Air Force was bombing schools in the north, there was a story in Sri Lankan media which didn't report anything about this massacre that happened in Nagarkovil. They were saying that there's a Tamil garment servant who is actually pretending to be an assistant labor commissioner, has brought bombs and hiding the bombs in Colombo to play, I mean, basically to plant it in schools. So this kind of, I mean, vicious, extremely vicious narratives basically fan the animosities, and it still does. This is the problem, actually. I think I can only be part of this. That's all I always say, part of the question instead of giving a proper answer, actually.
Mama poddakata vinadi pahakata yanna one. Me oyata puluwan nam me prashna tika dannawada?
අත්තස්සල තියෙන මම එකක් ගන්නම් ඊට පස්සේ ඔයා ගන්න හරි ඕකේ thank you comrade I will take one of the questions by Mr. Tamo Sridharan. I'll allow him to talk. Oh, hold on. I think I pressed the wrong one. Tamo, can you unmute and ask the question, please?
Yeah, I'll make it very quick. Thank you, Lionel. Just a quick question. Now that we have spoke about all this on a practical ground, would anyone be able to tell us in the next 30 days, what would you think happen in Sri Lanka now that we have a new president, lots of issues? Will our people get the medicine? Will our people get the food to the table? Our children will be able to go to school? Can they travel? Or a glimpse of hopes, can they get something? At least for the next 30 years, 30 days, Honorable Sanik, you know, other MPs or someone can give us some words of hope. Thank you.
Thank you. This is Shanakin here. I'm extremely sorry that my video is switched off. It's just because the power outage and my computer has 14% battery left. So I'll be with you all till my battery dies. The next 30 days, it looks like the next 30 days will be a little bit better than it has been in the last 3 months, which is what the economic experts are saying, because we have a few shipments of fuel and gas, that is cooking gas, has arrived. And we are being told that there may be a little bit of money that may come in. So the next 30 to, if that money comes in, I can't mention which country, but from a country, if that money comes in, the next 60 days would be maximum would be the next 60 days where we might have a little bit better than how it has been in the last 2 to 3 weeks. I mean, 2 to 3 weeks, especially in terms of shortages. But going forward, we the country needs, even if our IMF bailout program works out, and even if we do come to arrangement, it's a long, long, long process. I don't think this will be the new normal for the next at least 2 years is what I feel, because our dollar is not going to go back to what it was 6 months ago. And also our foreign reserves that are next to zero need to be built up for us to ensure that there are no shortages. And unless the shortages stop, there will be no tourism that contributes to our economy. So it doesn't look very great. And at least with an all-party government could have been formed and allowed for an all-party government to be formed and presidential powers abolished, we could have worked. We could have worked towards a system change, and we could have achieved at least the change in our political the setup in Sri Lanka during using this crisis as an opportunity. But I am concerned that with the appointment of the new president, how much we would achieve in terms of reforms, in terms of our political sphere also. And like I said during my first 15 minutes when I spoke, we need a large cash infusion that needs to come from some countries or investments. And for that to happen, one way forward is that the TNA can work with the government to bring in investments, when we need to give the investors the confidence through the political solution. It's not that we are trying to fish in muddy waters, but I think it's the right time to bring in changes right now. But there is no miracle that's going to happen for the economy to just revive itself on its own. The next one, like I said, the next month definitely will look a lot better than the last 3 weeks. And if that money comes in that is in discussion, maybe the second month also. But again, there is no clear picture on things getting better from there. Again, it will be again downhill, because there's a global recession that may happen, and there's a global food crisis. And now we have in Sri Lanka, we have man-made recession and a man-made food crisis because of the agriculture fertilizer ban. So things, unfortunately, I don't want to sound. I don't want to demotivate people, but I don't think things are going to be better very soon.
Yes. Can I say a few words? I am Mujibur Rahman here.
Yeah, very briefly.
Okay. Yeah, very briefly, because I'm extremely sorry because I had a power failure in this area because of I lost my Wi-Fi connection during my presentation. So anyway, that the last question that gentleman asked for the next 30 days, because I have a little bit different idea. The thing is this, now, you know, we know everybody knows Parliament has elected the president. He don't have any mandate from the people. The people expectations and the country's expectation is really different than the what parliamentarians, 134 parliamentarian has done in the parliament. So there is a big gap between the people's expectations and the parliament, right? So because of that, after Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe came to power, he has declared the emergency law, and in the afternoon, the one of the police officer came in the TV. And he is briefing about the emergency laws and that and this, all kind of things. Now, you know, so they are trying to, they are trying to put up some kind of pressure to the people's freedom and Aragalaya. So because of that, even the yesterday's incidents, I don't know how.
We again lost you, Mr. Rahman.
Yeah. I'm online. So I don't know how far this international community reacted of the Sri Lankan stable government, whether they will believe this is a stable government or this is a government the president has elected by parliament, no mandate from the people. So there is some kind of, you know, the issues in next 30 days or next 2 months in this country on behalf of the people's side. So still we can't say how government is going to handle this situation, how they are going to negotiation with the Aragalaya youths and the people, how they are going to defend the democracy, all kind of issues are there. But still we can't say how country is going to, on which way, whether IMF going to help this country or help this government, who doesn't have a mandate to the elected, if the president is not elected by the president, even the Podujana Peramuna, the previous president, he has resigned from his position. That means people rejected whole government, not only the president. People has rejected the Podujana Peramuna government. But unfortunately, because of that, our constitution, we have to elect the president through the parliament, who didn't have come to the parliament also through the Colombo district, but he got a mandate from the parliament to come as a president. So there's an issue in the future. So we have to wait and see what will happen in next 60 days.
Thank you, Mr. Rahman.
Thank you.
Next, I will give the chance to Mr. Thambiraja. I'll allow Mr. Thambiraja to talk. Please unmute.
Thank you for the panel for having me. It has been very instructive listening to various voices. I have just one question. I'll be very brief. I have one suggestion or a question for the panel. What are the, if there is a possibility of changing the constitution, which is very likely if the Aragalaya continues, what are the chances for separating the state and religion in our constitution, which has been one of the major issues that had been at the bottom of some of the problems that we have faced? Thank you.
Anybody on the panel? Comrade Bāshana? Yeah, all right.
Yes, that I think the Aragalaya movement, they have not touched on that issue, but they have put forward, there are a lot of reforms to the system and the constitution. But regarding that issue, what he asked from us, I think even Aragalaya has not touched that one.
Yeah, that's right. Comrade Bāshana, do you want to add anything about the separation of religion and the constitution? secular state. Microphone is muted. Your microphone is muted.
I have to agree with Mujibur about the way he basically mentioned about the way the Aragale sees these things. And I think this is not even a partial issue, a marginal issue for the Aragale, because I think anyway the state would not take the initiative of separating these two, because I mean there's no reason. I mean, it's completely serves the interest of the most of the politicians to keeping the religion and the politics together, state together. So I think if there's only possibility I can see is, I mean, if there's something going to happen like that, there needs to be a mass movement basically demanding to make the separation. So from the current, the ongoing protest campaigns, I don't see that that sort of a kind of a political tendency in any sense of the word inside the Aragale, actually.
Thank you, comrade. Next, I will give the opportunity to Caritas Anuradhapura. Please unmute and pose your question.
Okay, thank you, Mama. Bennett Miller, Pietuma, Kataharan, and Radhapurinda. Mata then Mithendi Sakachauna, Apita, Vishesha Magamika Sa, Jatika Sanghidia, Venuin, Samuika Katita Karandon, Kilamanga Tekanganoa, Namut ඒකම දැන් මේ පවතින අරගල රැල්ලත් එක්කලා අරගලයත් එක්කලා ගම්පලාත්‍ර විශේෂයෙන් මං අනුරාධපුර සහ පොළොන්නරුව දිස්ත්‍රික් වල මායින් ගම්මාන වල වැඩ කරපු පියතුමෙක් හැටියට මං දකිනවා රජයට හැරි මතවාදයක් තියෙනවා. නමුත් ක්‍රමයේ වෙනසක් වෙනුවෙන් මේ ජනතාව තුළ ඒතරම් අදහසක් නැහැ. ඉතින් ඒ නිසා මං අහන්න කැමති විශේෂයෙන්ම මෙතන ඉන්න ගරු මන්ත්‍රීවරුන් දෙදෙනාගෙන් ඔබලා දකුණේ විශේෂයෙන්ම දකුණේ මේ උතුරට තියෙන ප්‍රශ්න ඇත්තෙම ඒගායට සාධාරණත්ව ඉෂ්ට වෙන්න ඕන යුක්ති ඉෂ්ට වෙන්න ඕන ඔවුන්ගේ සිත් සොය සිදු වෙන්න ඕන නමුත් දකුණේ අර භාෂන් සහෝදරයා ඉස්මතු කළපු නැරටිව් එක we need to change the narrative in the south and I would like to know from the members of parliament present here what are the concrete actions you all have taken to do that in the south ඒක තමයි මගේ පළවෙනි ප්‍රශ්නේ දෙවෙනි එක තමයි දැන් භාෂන් සහෝදරයා ඉස්මතු කළා අන්තවාදී ජාතිවාදී සහ ධනවාදී අතර තියෙන සුසංයෝගය. එතකොට එවැනි පසුබිමක් තුළ දැන් අද කතා කළා මූල්‍ය අරමුදල ගැන IMF ගැන දැන් IMF එක හටානිද්දට ඇවිල්ලා අපිට බොහෝ දේවල් කියනවා විශේෂයෙන්ම දිලින්දුන්ට තවත් පහර වදින්න. එතකොට මෙතන ඉන්න මන්ත්‍රීවරුන් දෙදෙනාගෙන් අහන්න කැමති මේ රටේ දිලින්දන් ආරක්ෂා කරගැනීමෙන් ඕගොල්ලන්ගේ තියෙන සංවර්ධන උපාය මාර්ග සහ සැලසුම් මොනවද කියලා. ඒ වගේම දැන් මේ වෙද්දි බටහිර ප්‍රකාශන නිකුත් වෙනවා මේ ගහපු අයට විරුද්ධව. බොහොම හොඳයි ඒක වෙන්න ඕනනේ ඒක ඒගොල්ලෝ කරන්න ඕන. නමුත් මට තියෙනවා ප්‍රශ්නයක්. මේ ගැහුවේ ඉස්සරහට IMF එකත් එක්කලා අපේ සම්පත් විකුණන්න කියද්දී එළියට බහින්නෙත් මේ අයම තමයි. එළියට බහින්නෙත් අපිම තමයි. ඒකට පෙරහුරුවක්ද මේ කලේ? අද ප්‍රකාශ නිකුත් කරන තානාපති කාර්යාලය එදාට දන්නවා ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ සමාගම් වලටයි මේ සම්පත් විකුණන්නේ කියලා. ඉතින් අද ඔය නිකුත් කරපු ප්‍රකාශන මං හැල්ලුවට ලක් කරනවා නෙමේ. එක්සත් ජාතීන්ගේ සංගමයේ හැල්ලුවට ලක් කරනවා නෙමේ. නමුත් අපි දන්නවා ඒ වගේම කොෆි අනන් නිද්දි අර හුටු සහ තුත්සු ප්‍රශ්නේදී නිහඬව හිටියා යා. හරි මොකද ක්ලින්ටන් රාජ්‍යයකට සහයෝගය නොදුන්න නිසා. ඉතින් ඒ නිසා ඒවත් දැනගෙන මේ සමහරක් වෙලාවට නිකුත් කරන ප්‍රකාශන වල කොතෙක් දුරට යථාර්ථවාදී ගැබ් වෙලා තියෙනවද කියන එක ප්‍රශ්නයක් මතුවෙනවා මට. මම විශේෂයෙන්ම මෙතන ඉන්න මන්ත්‍රීවරුන් දෙදෙනාගෙන් අහනවා මොනවද ඔයගලංගෙ තියෙන උපාය මාර්ග සැලසුම්. And now we have been listening to the Aragalia people. And what are the changes you all have made internally in your respective political parties? What are the concrete changes you all have made? They say they are asking for a systematic change. Are you willing to do the system, bringing those systematic changes within your own parties? I would like to know from the members of parliament present here. Thank you.
Yeah, please. Could anybody respond to? I think there were three questions and they were focused. They were brought to the attention of the MPs here, I think.
Yeah. Oh. Mama Shanakyan Katakane. Atarama Madana Piyatuma Katakarine.
Oh.
ඔව් ඒ ඒ ඒකෙදි දෙමළ ජාතික සන්ධානයේ ඇවිල්ලා ඔබතුමාලා දන්නවා විශේෂයෙන්ම පහුගිය අපි ශ්‍රී ලංකාවේ අනාගතය පිළිබඳව ගන්න ඕන තීරණ වල හැම අවස්ථාවේදීම හරි තීන්දුව తీරන අරගෙන තියෙනවා විශේෂයෙන්ම 2018 විවස්ථාවට විරුද්ධව මහින්ද රාජපක්ෂ අගමැති බවට පත් කරපුනේ උසාවියට යන එක පමණක් නෙවෙයි පාර්ලිමේන්තුව ඇතුළෙත් අපි හරි දේ කරලා ඒ අවස්ථාවේ විවස්ථාවනුකූල අපි කොන්ස්ටිටියුෂන්ලි වැඩ කරා හැබැයි විශේෂයෙන්ම අපේ පක්ෂයේ පහුගිය දේශපාලනම වැඩ කටයුතු කර බැලුවම ශ්‍රී ලංකාවේ සියලු දිස්ත්‍රික් වල අපේ නියෝජනයක් නේ අපි උතුරු නැගෙනහිර නියෝජනය කරන්නේ ඉතින් අපි උතුරු නැගෙනහිර තමයි විශේෂයෙන්ම අපි විශේෂ අවධානය යොමු කළ තියෙන හැබැයි පසුගිය අවුරුදු දෙක තුළ මම විශේෂයෙන්ම මේ උතුරු නැගෙනහිර තියෙන ගැටලු පිළිබඳ දකුණේ දැනුවත් කිරීමක් කරන්න මම මට පුළුවන් උපරිමෙන් මම උත්සාහ කරලා තියෙනවා විශේෂයෙන්ම මේ ප්‍රිවෙන්ෂන් ඔෆ් ටෙරරිසම් ඇක්ට් එක වගේ දේවල් අහක් කරන්න ඕනේ ඒක හොඳ නෑ කියන එක ගැන සිග්නේචර් කැම්පේන් එකක් පවා දකුණේ මාතර ගාල්ල වගේ දිස්ත්‍රික්කවලත් අපි එහෙම දේවල් ඒ වැඩ පිළිකර මහනුවර කරා ඉතින් ඒ වගේ පුළුවන් තරම් උත්සාහ කරනවා මේ 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 දේවල් අපි මගේ පක්ෂයේ හැටියට මම පක්ෂයක් වශයෙන් අපි වැඩ කරේ නැතත් මම පෞද්ගලිකව මේ ගම්මට්ටමට මේ මේ හැම මේ ප්‍රිවෙන්ෂන් ඔෆ් ටෙරරිසම් වගේ අනිත් දේවල් ගැනත් කරන්න උත්සාහ කරනවා ඊට අමතරව IMF එකේ දිලින්දන්ට ඇත්තටම vulnerable families අපි ප්‍රොටෙක්ට් කරන්න අවශ්‍යයි ඒකට අපි කොහොමද කරන්න කියන එකට වැඩපිළිවෙලක් අනිවාර්යයෙන්ම හදන්න වෙ තියෙනවා අපි ආර්ථික විශේෂඥයෙක් එක්ක අපි සාකච්ඡා කරලා අපි ඇත්තටම වැඩපිළිවෙලකුත් පක්ෂයක් වශයෙන්ුත් අපි සුමන්ත ගරු සුමන්දරන් මන්තුමා එයා හිටපු ෆිනෑන්ස් කමිටි චෙයා හැටියට අපි වැඩපිළිවෙලක් අපි සකස් කරා හැබැයි ඉතින් ඒ දේවල් ගොඩක් දේවල් කරන්න මම කිව්වා වගේම ඉස්සෙල්ලම ලොකෝ කෑෂ් ඉන්ෆියුෂන් එකක් ඕනේ IMF එක කියන්නේ අපිට දැනට තියෙන මීඩියට කෙනෙක් පමණයි මම දකින්න විදිහට ඉතින් අපේ ලෝන්ස් ටික රීස්ට්‍රක්චර් කරන්න මොකද අපිට අපේ ලංකා ඉතිහාසය ගත්තම අපේ ප්‍රයිමරි බැලන්ස් එකේ ඩෙෆිසිට් එකක් අනුව තමයි බජට් එකේ අපි අවුරුදු 4ක් කර අනිත් හැම කාලෙම තිබිලා තියෙන ඉතින් අපි ලෝන් අරගෙන තමයි බජට් එකේ ඩෙෆිසිට් එක පියවගෙන තියෙන්නේ මේ ගත්ත වැරදි මේ බදු ප්‍රතිපත්ති නිසා අපිට ණය ගැනීමේ අවස්ථාව අහිමි වීම තුළින් තමයි අපිට මුදල් ණයට ගන්න ලබා ගන්න බැරි වෙලා තමයි මේ තිබ්බ ෆොරින් රිසර්ස් භාවිත කර ඒක නිසා IMF එකත් එක්ක සමගාමීව අපිට කෑෂ් ඉන්ෆියුෂන්ස් ගේන්න වැඩපිළිවෙලක් කරන්න අනිවාර්යයෙන්ම අවශ්‍යයි ලොකු මහා පරිමාණයේ ආයෝජන ගේන්න ඒ කියන්නේ ආයෝජන කියලා කිව්වම ලංකාවේ ගත්තම පහුගිය කාලේ සැන්ග්‍රිලා හෝටලේ සින්නක්කර විකිණීම කරලා ඒගොල්ලන්ට බදු සහනක් දීම ආයෝජනයක් කේ හැටියට තමයි පෙන්නලා තින්නේ මං කියන්නේ එහෙම ආයෝජන නෙමෙයි ලංකාවේ කනෙක්ටිවිටි අපේ තියෙන එයාපෝර්ට්ස් ස්පෝර්ට්ස් උතුරු නැගෙනහිර විශේෂයෙන්ම තිරුකුණාමලයේ වරාය වගේ දේවල් කමර්ෂල් වලට අපි පටන් ගැනීම තුළින් ඒ ප්‍රදේශවල අපිට වැඩිපුර ආයෝජන ගේන්න එහෙම ක්‍රමවේදයක් නැතුව මං හිතන්නේ IMF එක විතරක් එක වැඩපිළිවෙලක් හැටියට අපිට මේ ගෙනියන්න පුළුවන් කියලා අපි මේ වගේ ප්‍රොපෝසල්ස් අපි දීලා තියෙනවා. ඉතින් හැම අවස්ථාවෙදීම සමගි ජන බල වේගයයි අපි මේ වගේ දේවල් අපි එකට වැඩ කරලා තියෙනවා. ඉතින් මං හිතන්නේ දකුණේ ජනතාවට තියෙන මේ මේ ගොඩක් ගැටලු ගැන දැනුවත් කිරීමේ මේ වගකීම ගොඩක් දුරට සමගි ජන බල වේගයේ තමයි ඒකට කරන්න හැකියාවක් තියෙන. මොකද ඒගොල්ලන් තමයි දකුණේ හැම දිස්ත්‍රික්කෙම වගේ නියෝජිතව ඉන්නේ. ඉතින් ඒක නිසා මං හිතනවා මුජිබුර් මන්තතුමා එක්ගෙන පැහැදිලි කිරීමක් කරයි කියලා.
ඔව් ස්තුතියි සානක්‍ය මන්ත්‍රීතුමා. දැන් අය පියතුමා ආපු විදියට මේ ප්‍රධාන ප්‍රශ්නේ මේ දකුණේ ජනතාව දැනුවත් කිරීම හා මේ රටේ මේ ජාතික සංහිඳියාව හා එකමුතුව හදා ගැනීම පැත්තෙන් ඇත්තටම අලුත් පක්ෂයක් හැටියට සමගි ජන බලවේගී ඉන්න තරුණ මන්ත්‍රීවරු අපි විශාල ලෙස මේ ප්‍රශ්නය ජාතික ප්‍රශ්නය මේක විසඳ ගන්න ඕනේ කියන එක ඒක පළමු තැනට දාලා තමයි අපේ සියලු වැඩ කටයුතු කරන්නේ. එවෙනුවෙන් අලුත් ව්‍යවස්ථාව හැදීම පැත්තෙන් උත් අපි මේක 13 වෙනි සංශෝධනයේට එහා ගිය විසඳුමක් මේකට හොයන්න ඕනේ. ඒකට සියලු දෙනාගේම එකඟත්වය ගන්න ඕනේ කියන පදනම උඩත් මම හිතන්නේ මේ උතුරේ නැගෙනහිර නියෝජනය කරන සියලුම දේශපාලන පක්ෂත් එක්ක එකතු වෙලා යම් කෙටුම්පතකුත් අපි හදලා තියෙනවා මේ පිළිබඳව විශේෂයෙන්ම ආණ්ඩු ක්‍රම ව්‍යවස්ථාව සංශෝධනයේදී ඉදිරිපත් කරන්න. ඒකෙදි විශේෂයෙන්ම දකුණේ ඉන්න ජනතාව අතරත් අපේ ඉන්න පාර්ලිමේන්තු මන්ත්‍රීවරු ඒ ආපු තරුණ මන්ත්‍රීවරු අපි දකින විදියට නම් විශේෂයෙන්ම මම දකින විදියට පෞද්ගලිකව හොඳ තැනක ඉන්නවා. ඒගොල්ලෝ පොසිටිව් ධනාත්මකව හිතෙන අලුත් විදියට කල්පනා කරන මේක චේන්ජ් එක වෙන්න ඕනේ. මෙතන ජාතික සංහිඳියාව විකමුතුව හදාගන්න ඕනේ ශ්‍රී ලාංකිකයන් හැටියට වැඩ කරන්න පුළුවන් ඒ මේ අභිලාෂයන් හා ඒ ආකල්පමය වෙනසකුත් රට තුළ ඇති කරන්න ඕනේ කියන මේ මූලික අදහස උඩ ඉඳන් වැඩ කරනවා. ඇත්තටම අපි අලුත් පක්ෂයක් හැටියටත් මේ අලුත් අදහස් එක්ක ඉස්සරහට යන්න ඕනේ කියන එක ප්‍රධාන ලෙසින් පිළිගෙන ඒ හරහා තමයි වැඩ කටයුතු වෙන්නේ. අනිත් පැත්තෙන් ආර්ථික පැත්තෙන් කියතුමා ආපු විදිය මේ විශේෂයෙන්ම මේ දරිද්‍රතාවයට මුහුණ දීලා ඉන්න ජනතාව වෙනුවෙන් කරන වැඩසටහන ගැනත් අපි ඇත්තටම මේ පෞගිය සති කීපය තුළ අපේ පක්ෂයේ ඉන්න ආර්ථිකය සම්බන්ධව වැඩ කරන හර්ෂදි සිල්වා ආචාර්යතුමාත් ඒ වගේම කබීර් හෂීම් ඒ වගේම ඉරාන් වික්‍රමරත්න එතුමන්ලා එකතු වෙලා යම් කෙටුම් පතකුත් හදලා තියෙනවා. විශේෂයෙන්ම මේ රට මේ මුහුණ දීලා තියෙන ආර්ථිකයෙන් ගොඩ එන්න පුළුවන් ක්‍රමවේදයක් හා වැඩසටහනක්. ඒක පෞගිය සතිය තුළ පාර්ලිමේන්තුවේ නියෝජනය කරන සියලුම පක්ෂ අතර සාකච්ඡාවට ලක් කරා. සියලුම දෙනාම ඒකට එකඟවත් වුණා. විශේෂයෙන්ම සර්වපාක්ෂික ආණ්ඩුවක් තුළ අපිට යම් අවුරුද්දක් හෝ අවුරුදු එකහමාරක් හෝ ඒ යම් කාල සීමාවකට මේ ආර්ථික තත්ත්වයට මුහුණ දෙන්න පුළුවන් මේ වැඩසටහන ක්‍රියාත්මක කරගෙන ඊළඟට අපිට මැතිවරණයකට යන්න පුළුවන් කියන ඒ අදහස උඩ ඒ ආර්ථික සැලැස්ම දැන් හදලා තියෙනවා. ඒක මට මේ පියතුමා මට සම්බන්ධ කරගන්න පුළුවන් නම් පියතුමාට මේ වැඩසටහනෙන් පස්සේ මාව මට පුළුවන් ඒකේ කෙටුම් පතක් ඒ තිබෙන ලියලා තියෙන ලියවිල්ලේ ලියවිල්ලක් මේ පියතුමාට මට ලැබෙන්න සලස්සන්නත් පුළුවන්. මොකද ඒක හොඳ ලියවිල්ලක්. ඒකේ ආර්ථික විශේෂඥයන්ගේ ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ මත අදහස් අරගෙන හදපු කෙටුම් වැඩපිළිවෙලක්. ඒකට පාර්ලිමේන්තුවේ නියෝජනය කරන විශේෂයෙන්ම දැන්ට පොදු ජන පෙරමුණෙන් කැඩිලා ආපු ඒ දළස්සලා පෙරමුණ මන්ත්‍රීතුමාලාගේ කණ්ඩායම පවා ඒකේ සාකච්ඡා වලට ඒගොල්ලෝ උත් පැමිණිලා ඒකත් ඒගොල්ලෝ පිළි අරන් තිබුණා. මේක අපිට දැනට මේ අවුරුද්දකට වයිකහමාරකට මේක ක්‍රියාත්මක කරන්න පුළුවන් හොඳ වැඩසටහනක්. ඒක තුළ මේ සමාජයේ දරිද්‍රතාවය හා අඩු ආදායම් ලාභීන් ඉන්න ජන කොටසටත් ඒකේ පිළිතුරු අපි ලබා දීලා තිබෙනවා.
හරි, බොහොම ස්තුතියි. මේ ශ්‍රාවන් මා හිතන්නේ මේ ශාක්‍යන් මන්ත්‍රීතුමා ඉවර වුණා. මොකද පැය දෙකහමාරක් ගත වුණා අපේ මේකට. නමුත් මම දිගටම මේක කරගෙන යන්නම්. ඊළඟට අමල් අබේවර්ධනට ප්‍රශ්නයන් කෙටියෙන් අහන්න තව ගොඩක් අය ඉන්න නිසා අන්මියුට් කරලා ප්‍රශ්නයන්. අමල්
Hello, I'm calling from London, England, and I'd like to congratulate. Let me just turn off my, can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah, continue.
Yeah, I'm just calling from London. I'd like to thank the organizers for this talk. I was listening, I haven't listened to the whole discussion, but I was listening to what Bāshana was saying about the basically about the insecurity that the majority community have about confronting their past. And I would largely agree with that. And that's probably one of the reasons why we're not making much progress on reconciliation. So given that and given our legacy of conflict really throughout our independence and our failed economic progress in the world compared to many other countries, to really reset and have this system change that I think we all would like to see, and certainly the Aragalea would like to see. I would like to know what the panelists think about actually moving ahead with the Truth Commission and whether we can move that up the agenda, both in terms of what the Aragalea wants and what Parliament wants and what the people should want. So that's my question, whether we can have a healing process along the lines of a Truth and Reconciliation Commission that has happened in other countries that have experienced conflicts such as South Africa, Colombia, and many other countries, and whether we can make that kind of bold step. Thank you.
Thank you, Amal. Anybody, Comrade Bāshana would be the best person to respond to that question, I think.
Yeah, just a quick response, actually. I think, I mean, conceptual level, it may be the best idea, but when you apply it to the practical world, it's far. I think the idea of having the Truth Commission in the Sri Lankan context is quite a. I'm not trying to be pessimistic about it, but when the reality is, reality is pessimist. You can't be a realist without being a pessimist as well. So in that sense, I think, because there's always a kind of notion that what truth we like to hear. This is what determines, because, this is the fundamental difference with the South African. Because South African Truth Commission, if you look at the power pattern, the South African Truth Commission, it's the victims who decided to initiate the Truth Commission and listen to the stories, and they just wanted to know what happened to their kith and kin, actually. And which is not the case in Sri Lanka, because we have already a truth that has been, state-sponsored and well-consolidated truth, which we don't want to come out of that truth. And that manufactured truth is what will be challenged if you are going to have a genuine truth commission. So I think, in my opinion, even though it's a kind of a brilliant idea, in any society where such long protracted conflicts have happened, I think in the Sri Lankan context, because I think to know the truth, it's a political matter. It's not simply the curiosity, but it's a political decision people have to take. The society has to be prepared, and the political parties need to take the kind of initiative to prepare people to listen to the truth. And that initiative, I can't see, for the next, decade, or I don't know whether I will see that such a thing in my lifetime, because it's quite, we can't fathom the fact that there had been atrocities committed, the basic fact. Despite the Aragale, for all this, months, there was not a single attempt made, for example, to watch collectively, to watch the documentaries that were, done about the past, about what happened in the war, and even what happened in the early periods. And there had been no attempt to collectively watch, because it's a political exercise if people decide to watch them. And so that sort of political approach prevents us from actually seeing the truth. So because truth is a matter of choice, actually. It's not simply whether you like to see the truth or not. It's a decision that you have to take. You want to know the truth. So that political decision is quite weak, actually, in the country, as far as I see. I know people who are quite willing to do such, take such initiatives, but from the state level, like a massive project, like a truth commission, it's hardly see the possibility of happening it, actually, to be honest.
Thank you. Next, I will give the chance to Comrade Jalad Bandara. Unmute and please post your question.
Mangatun prasne ne mang sakatcha avasthawata sambandhine balan hiti. Mage yojanawa me samanya me wage arbudhakari tattweka innakota tamai aanduwakin apita visandum hoya ganna puluwan wenna. Smoothly inna welawaka hoya ganna ba. Dan ettharam me mang meka ලඝු කරනවා විශේෂයෙන්ම මේ අපේ රටේ ජනවර්ග ප්‍රශ්නේ පිළිබඳව සාකච්ඡාව එතෙන්ද සම්බන්ධින්ද සමස්තෙත් ඒකට සම්බන්ධයි දැන් ඇත්තටම මේක රාජ්‍ය ප්‍රසංස්කරණය කරන්න ඕන වැඩක් නේ බලය බෙදා හදා ගැනීම කියන සංකල්ප එක්ක යන්නේ එතකොට දැන් අපිට තියෙන අත්දැකීම තමයි ඔච්චර සාකච්ඡා කරත් පාර්ලිමේන්තුවෙන් තමයි ඒක ව්‍යවස්ථාව සම්පාදනය කරගන්නේ අපි දැක්කා 2010 ව්‍යවස්ථාව අපි සෑහෙන මහන්සි වෙලා එක හදලා දැම්මා නමුත් ඒක ඉරලා දැම්මා. හැබැයි ඒක සම්මත වුණා නම් යුද්ධයේ ඇති වෙන තිබිච්ච ඉඩකඩක් තුනක් ඇහිරෙන්න තිබුණා. ඊට පස්සේ ආ තිස්ස විතරණ කමිටුව අවුරුද්දක් උතර රැස් වෙලා හදපු වார்த்தාව ඒක පාර්ලිමේන්තුවේ දැම්මේවත් නැහැ. ඊට පස්සේ ලාල් විජේනායක ව්‍යවස්ථා සම්පාදන වැඩසටහන ඒක ඉස්සරහට ගියෙත් නැහැ. ඒකට අපට තේරෙනවා මේ අශීලාචාර මිනිස්සු ඉන්න පාර්ලිමේන්තුවෙන් මේ වැඩේ කරගන්න බැහැ. ඒ නිසා අපි වික්ටයිවන් සෝදරගේ අපි කණ්ඩායමක් එකතු වෙලා ප්‍රසස් කරන ව්‍යාපාරයක් අපි සාකච්ඡා කළා සියලු දේශපාලන පක්ෂ වලට අපි දීලා තියෙනවා මම මෙතෙන්ට කියන්නේ ඒකේ අපි යෝජනා කරන්නේ දැන් මේ මන්ත්‍රී උදේපල ඉන්නවද මන් දන්නේ නැහැ ඔබට අවස්ථාවක් කෙනවද මොකද මේ ජනාධිපතිවරයා තමයි අරක ඉරා දැමුවේ ඔය කාර්ලා ඔක්කොම සම්බන්ධෙක් කෙනා දැන් ඔහු අඬ ගහනවා සර්වපාක්ෂික රජයක් හදන්න ඒ ඔබට ඔබ යෝජනා කරොත් මේ ගැටළු උත්තර දෙනවද ඕගොල්ලෝ ව්‍යවස්ථා සම්පාදක යනකොත් අනිවාර්යෙන් ඔව් කියනවා ඔව් කියනවා ඔව් කියලා ආණ්ඩු හදනවා මොකද ඔව් කියන්නේ උන් දන්නවා පාර්ලිමේන්තුවෙන් 3-2 ගන්න බෑ කියලා අන්න ඒ නිසා අපි යෝජනා කරලා තියෙනවා අර සවුත් අප්‍රිකා ක්‍රමයට හදන්න කියලා ව්‍යවස්ථා සම්පාදන මණ්ඩලයක් ඒක සර්වපාක්ෂික ආණ්ඩුවකට කරන්න පුළුවන් පොඩි නීතිමය වෙනස්කමක් විතරයි කරගන්න ඕනේ ඒකට තමයි අපි සටන් කරන්න ඕනේ මේ සිස්ටම් එක චේන්ජ් කරන්න නම් ඒකට පාර්ලිමේන්තු මන්ත්‍රීවරුගුණි අපි යෝජනා කරන 50ක පමණ ප්‍රමාණයක් ඊළඟට සාමාන්‍ය ප්‍රජාව ඒ කියන්නේ මේ වගේ සිවුලු ජන වර්ග නියෝජනය වලදීට අරගල භූමි කණ්ඩායමක් ඒ වගේම විශ්වවිද්‍යාල කොටස් ඒ වගේ විවිධ ශේෂ්ත්‍රයේ ඉන්නවා ඒ ශේෂ්ත්‍ර වලින් තව 100කුත් අරගෙන කන්ස්ටිටියුෂන් ඇසම්බ්ලි එක නැත්නම් ව්‍යවස්ථා සම්පාදන මණ්ඩලයක් හදන්න. ඉතින් මේ මණ්ඩලය තමයි මේ ව්‍යවස්ථාව හරිගස්සන්නේ ඒක අනුමත කරන්නේ අවසානයේ තමයි ජනමත විචාරකට යන්නේ. දැන් අපේ තියෙන ක්‍රමයේ උඩ ජනමත විචාරකට ගේන්නවත් බෑ පාර්ලිමේන්තුම විසිකරනවා. අන්න ඒකට අතුරු ව්‍යවස්ථාවක් හරිගස්ස ගන්න ඕනේ. මම යෝජනා කරන්නේ මේ යෝජනාව විස්තරට ගෙනියන්න කියලා කවුරු හරි ප්‍රශ්න කළොත් මට කියන්න තියෙන්නේ දැනට ලෝකේ රටවල් 33ක් පමණ ඒ වැඩි කරගත්තා. දැනට මේ මොහොතේ වෙනකොටත් ඒක චිලිය කියන රාජ්‍යයේ ඒ ශිෂ්‍යෝ ගෙනිච්ච අරගලේ ලංකා වර්ගලට වඩා වෙනස්. ඔවුන් සිස්ටම් චේන්ජ් එක කරගන්න ඒ සාකච්ඡාවේ යෙදිලා ඉන්නවා. අතුරු ව්‍යවස්ථාවක් ගෙනැල්ලා අන්තර් පාලනයකට ගිහිල්ලා සර්වපාක්ෂික ආණ්ඩුවක් හදාගෙන යනවා. ඒ විදිහම වැඩක් දැන් ලෙබනන්ලොත් සිද්ධ වෙනවා. මම යෝජනා කරන්නේ මෙන්න මේ කණ්ඩායම මේ වෙලාවේ තමයි කොටු කරගන්න පුළුවන්. හැබැයි මේගොල්ලෝ කියයි ව්‍යවස්ථාව හදනවා අපි කියන පොරොන්දුව දෙයි. නමුත් ඉතිහාස අත්දැකීම මේ ඉන්න පාර්ලිමේන්තුව අමුම අමු ජාතිවාදීන් වැඩි පිටසක් පිරලා ඉන්න පාර්ලිමේන්තුවක්. විශේෂයෙන් පෝට්ටුවේ. එතකොට 150ක් ගන්න එපා. ඒ ප්‍රශ්නේ තියෙනවා. මේක තමයි මට කරන්න තියෙන යෝජනාව. ඔබලාට ළඟදිම ওই മന്ത്രിවරු දෙපළට ආරාධනය කරයි. ওই മന്ത്രിවරු දෙපළක් දන්නවා අපි යෝජනා කරපු දේ ඒ සාකච්ඡාවල ඔබේ නායකවරු හිටියා. මම හිතන්නේ රහුමාන් මන්ත්‍රීතුමා අපි කතා කරන දවසේ මේ සජිත් මහත්තයත් එක්ක හිටියා. ශානක්‍ය මන්ත්‍රීතුමාගේ නායකවරයා තමයි දැන් සම්බන්ධ වුණේ සුමන්දිරෙන් මන්ත්‍රීවරයා. මම ඔබ දෙපළට කියන්නේ මෙන්න මේ සාකච්ඡාව ඉස්සරහට ගෙනියන්න කියලා අපි මේ සංවිධානයට මේක තමයි කරන්න ඕන දේ. බොහොම ස්තුතියි.
හොඳයි බෙතර මන්ත්‍රීවරු දෙන්නම දැන් ඉවත් වෙලා මොකද අපේ කාල සීමාව ඉවර වෙච්ච නිසා ඒ ඔබ ගෙනාපු යෝජනාව ඒ දෙන්නට දන්නන්න බොහොම ස්තුතියි. ඊළඟට මේ අනිත් අවස්ථාව දෙනවා voice of world can you please unmute and post the question quickly.
Hello, මම චාමරි මදනායක මම ස්වීඩන් වලින් ඉඳලා කතා කරන්නේ. ඔබලගේ සාකච්ඡාවට ගොඩක් ස්තුතියි. මම හැම දෙයක්ම බොහොම සාවධානව අහගෙන හිටියා. මට ඇත්තටම මිස්ටර් ශාක්‍යෙන්ට තමයි මට මේ ප්‍රශ්න යොමු කරන්න උවමනාව තියෙන. මොකද වර්තමානයේදී ලෝකයේ ගෝලීය ආර්ථික අර්බුදය එක්කම ලෝකයේ සංදිස්ථාන දෙකක් අපි මූණ දෙමින් සිටිනවා ජාත්‍යන්තරේ. ඒ කියන්නේ එකක් යුක්‍රේන රුසියාව, අනිත් එක පාරිසරික යුද්ධය. ඒ කියන්නේ එන්වයරන්මන්ට් වෝ එකක්. ඒතකොට මට මේ දෙකම අපේ රටට මේ පුදුම විදිහකට බලපාන සිද්ධීන් දෙකක්. මට විශේෂ ශාක්‍යකින් මට අහන්න උවමනාවක් තිබ්බා. මේ දෙක ජාති ආගම් ભેදයක් නෑ. අපිට මේ ප්‍රශ්න දෙක අපිට මහ පරිමාණයෙන් හෝ සුළු පරිමාණයෙන් අපේ රටට ආර්ථිකයට බලපානවා. ඒකේ අපි දැනටමත් ඒ ආර්ථික අර්බුදයස්ස අපේ රට බලවත් ලෙස අපි ඒ අර්බුදයට මුහුණ පාලා තියෙනවා. නමුත් ප්‍රශ්නෙකට තියෙන මේවා ගැන දැනුවත් වීම ලංකාවේ ගොඩක් අඩුයි. ශාක්‍යන්ගේ අදහස මට දැනගන්න උවමනායි වෙලා තිබ්බා. මේ යුද්ධ දෙකට වර්තමානයේදී නෙවෙයි තව දුරටත් ඉදිරියටත් අපිට මුහුණ පාන්න වෙනවා. එතකොට අපිට ජනවාර්ගික ප්‍රශ්නයක් විදියට නෙවෙයි ඇත්තටම අපිට දැන් තියෙන ජනවාර්ගික ප්‍රශ්නයක්. අපිට ජාති ආගම් ප්‍රශ්නයක් තියෙනවා. මේ ඔක්කොම නැතුව මේ පොදුවේ ජාත්‍යන්තරව ඇතිවලා තියෙන ප්‍රශ්නට මිස්ටර් ශාකින් කොහොමද මුණ දෙන්නේ කියන එක අපි ශ්‍රී ලංකාවේ ලාංකිකයෝ විදියට අපි දැනගන්න කැමතියි. මට ඒකට උත්තරයක් ගන්න මම හිතන්නේ එතුම මේ අවස්ථාව මෙතන නැහැ.
ඔව්. අපි මේ ප්‍රශ්නය මේ මේ රෙකෝඩින්ග් ක අපි මේ මේ සෝෂල් මීඩියා වල දානවා. මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ අපි යොමු කරන්නම් මිස් ශානික්‍යන්ට පිළිතුරක් සපයන්න කියලා. මේ ඔයාගේ නම මොකද්ද?
මගේ නම චාමලී මදනායක. මම ඉන්නේ ස්වීඩන් ස්ටොක්හෝම් නගරේ ඉන්නේ.
ඔව් පොඩ්ඩක් ඊමේල් ඇඩ්‍රස් එකයි ඊළඟට ඒ නමයි දාන්න. එතකොට ඒක අපි යවන්නම් මේ මේ මිස්ටර් ශානික්‍යන්ට පිළිතුරක් දෙන්න කියලා. නැහරි බොහොම
ඕකේ. Thank you very much. ගොඩක් ස්තුතියි.
තව ප්‍රශ්න තුනක් තියෙනවා. හැබැයි මේ තුන් දෙනාම කලින් ප්‍රශ්න අහපු අය විලි, ෂකීර්, අමල්. මම හිතන්නේ මෙතන අපිට මේ Q&A session එකේ ප්‍රශ්න 50ක් දැනට තියෙනවා. මම හිතන්නේ ඒවට පිළිතුරු දෙන්න මම තුන්වෙනි අවස්ථාවක් ලබාගන්න පුළුවන් දෙකට දැනට පැය 2 විනාඩි 45ක් ගිහිලා තියෙනවා. මේ පැනලිස්ට්ලා දෙන්නෙක් නැහැ. දැන් ඉන්නේ මේ භාෂණ සහෝදරය විතරයි. භාෂණ සහෝදරය කැමති නම් මේ ප්‍රශ්න වලින් කීපයක් විතරක් තෝරගෙන ප්‍රශ්න 50ක් යන එක ලේසි නැහැ. එතනින් එහෙම අරගන්න පුළුවන්. චැට් එකෙත් එක ප්‍රශ්නයක් අහලා තියෙනවා රමණී තොටගමුව. Do you think chat එකේ නෙවෙයි Facebook එකේ do you think the opposition plays its role in the parliament? ඒක මේ සරල ප්‍රශ්නයක්. නමුත් මෙතන ඊට වැඩිය ගොඩාක් ප්‍රශ්න මේක අහලා තියෙනවා. සූර්ය අහලා තියෙනවා. නෑ මම ඒක ප්‍රශ්නයකින් එක කියවන්නේ ගියොත් අසාධාරණයක් කරයි. භාෂණ සහෝදරයාට කැමතිද එහෙම පිටුරු දෙ කීපයක් දෙන්න? එහෙම නැත්නම් අපිට අවසන් කරන්න පුළුවන් මේ session එක.
මම හිතන්නේ ප්‍රශ්න ගොඩක් තියෙනවා නේද?
ඔව් ඒක තමයි ප්‍රශ්න 50ක් තියෙනවා මේ Q&A. අපි මේක රෙකෝඩ් එකක් හරි තියාගෙන වෙලා තියෙන්නේ මේ කට්ටියගේ මේ ඇඩ්‍රස් උත් නැහැනේ ඊමේල් ඇඩ්‍රස් වරමයක් නැහැ. ඒක නිසා ටිකක් අමාරු වෙනවා අපිට පිළිතුරු දෙන්න. දැන් ප්‍රශ්න වලට පිළිතුරු අවශ්‍ය කරන අයට පුළුවන් නම් මේකේ chat line එකේ දාන්න ඒ ප්‍රශ්නයක් කොපි කරන්න පුළුවන් ලේසියෙන්. ප්‍රශ්නය ඊමේල් ඇඩ්‍රස් එකයි නමයි දාලා එවුවොත් මේ chat එක save කරන නිසා එතකොට ඒ සේරම ටික save වෙනවා. ඊට පස්සේ අපිට බලන්න පුළුවන් මේ ප්‍රශ්න වලට උත්තරයක් මේ එවන්න පුළුවන්ද කියලා. ඒක තමයි දැනට කරන්න පුළුවන් විදිය. මොකද කාල සීමාව සෑහෙන ඉවත් වෙලා අනිත් එක මෙතන පැනලිස්ට්ලා දෙන්නේ අඩු නිසා. වාචන සහෝදරය මොකද හිතන්නේ?
ඒක හොඳයි මම හිතන්නේ.
කැමති කෙනෙක් ඉන්නවනම් අපි තව විනාඩි 5ක් දෙන්නම්. ඔයගොල්ලන්ගේ ඊමේල් ඇඩ්‍රස් එකයි නමයි මේ ප්‍රශ්නය මෙතන මේ Q&A එකේ තියෙන එක කොපි කරලා chat එකට දාන්න කෙලින්ම. Q&A එක save වෙනවද? මම හිතන්නේ Q&A එක save වෙනවා කියලා. Q&A එක save කරන්න බෑ. හොඳයි. ඒක කරන අතරේ I would like to thank everybody, especially the three panelists, Comrade Bāshana Abeywardane and MP Shanikyan and MP Rahman for their contributions. And I think contributions on the one hand, it enlightened us in some of the aspects on which we have an interest, as well as some interesting issues that were brought up during the discussion. And we also thank the audience, without which our effort wouldn't have been successful. So and also I would like to thank the two interpreters, Mr. Mansoor and Ms. Sena Ratna. And finally, I would like to thank Mr. Anthony Gresham and Mr. Ranjit Teerasinghe for sorting out the administrative matters as well as helping in the technical issues. And I think that's it, basically. So I will conclude this session and thank you very much for your participation. And from here, I have to say good night. But for those in other areas, good morning and good evening, depending on where you are. All right. Thank you very much, and let us call it a day.